Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind all those using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Ariane Burgess will be joining us at approximately 9:45, and this morning we have Emma Harper substituting for Christine Graham, so good morning. Our first item of business is an evidence session on the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Scotland Bill, and I welcome to the meeting our first panel of witnesses from the Grouse Muir Management Review Group. We have Professor Alan Werity, the Chair, Professor Ian Newton, the Member, and Professor Colin Reid, also a Member. This morning we have about 90 minutes scheduled for this session. So I'll kick off with the first question. So the Werity report recommended in 2019 a licensing scheme be introduced for the shooting of grouse if within 5 years there was no marked improvement in the sustainability of grouse moor management, as evidenced by the population of certain breeds of raptors. Can I ask you, Professor Werity, whether there's sufficiently strong evidence of wildlife crime on grouse moors to justify the intervention of licensing, and do you believe that the legislation in the face of the bill reflects the position that your review intended?
We started in terms of our remit by considering the SNH's 2017 report, which demonstrated that a third of tag golden eagles had disappeared in mysterious circumstances. The way it was put, disappeared in suspicious circumstances on or around grouse moors. And we confirmed that suspicion in our findings. There is a clear spatial association between the recovery of illegally killed raptors and managed land for grouse shooting. At that stage, we were unable to produce a map demonstrating that association, although I understand since then that Hugh Dignam may be able to provide you with such a map. We had privileged access to information from Police Scotland to underpin our recommendations and our support our findings. Since then, time has moved on. I have not had access to the same amount of data which was available to me as chair of that review group. But I turn particularly to Professor Newton, who I think can provide us with an update on the situation since we reported.
Thank you, Alan. Well, the situation as we understand it since the report is that persecution of birds of prey has not declined substantially in the years since the report was written. In fact, during the year with most lockdown, which I think was 2020, the rate of killing, or the number of cases reported to the RSPB, was the highest so far this century. In other words, when there were fewer people in the countryside, the level of persecution almost certainly increased. I think the total for Britain as a whole in that year was 146 cases, of which 26 were from Scotland. The following year, 2021, the numbers were still high. They dropped somewhat. I think the total for the whole of Britain then was 108 and about 17 for Scotland. The report for 2022, the crime report that the RSPB produces every year, those figures are not yet available, but I understand that the figures are of similar magnitude to what they were in the past. Now, there's a limit to the emphasis that we can put on these figures, because they depend on carcasses or other evidence being found largely by chance in the countryside and reported. So the general feeling among conservationists, at any rate, is that these figures represent the tip of an iceberg. But nonetheless, the significant thing is that they've not really declined, statistically significant, since the report was written.
You're referring to an RSPB report, which is not independent. Surely the National Wildlife Crime Report would be the body or the place where such findings would be reported. And can you tell us whether, I think you said there was 26 cases in Scotland. Do those refer specifically to grouse moor?
No, they're the country as a whole. Not all would be grouse moor.
Okay.
Some would be lowland areas.
And on the point around the evidence, it's now between somewhere like 8 to 15 years since there's been a review from the Scottish Government or whatever that would inform the National Wildlife Crime Report. Why are we about to bring in legislation which would appear to depend on research done by RSPB?
Well, RSPB have traditionally been the body that has collated this sort of information. But one has to remember that it's not the RSPB that collects this information, it's the members of the public. And most of the survey work of raptor populations in Scotland have been done by what we now call the Scottish Raptor Groups. These are groups of interested amateurs, citizen scientists would be the word we use these days, that go out and monitor raptors of various species in their home areas by checking all the known sites every year. So there's a broad body of people that are responsible for collecting this information, people drawn from all walks of life. The fact that RSPB collate the information, or most of the information, is because they're the organisation concerned with bird protection and have the biggest interest in it.
OK, thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. The Bill sets out a range of relevant offences in relation to which a Section 16AA licence may be revoked or suspended. Do you agree that this list of offences is relevant and appropriate?
Yes, it is. I think the problem so far, as I'm sure you're aware, is that one needs criminal evidence or sufficient evidence for a criminal court to prosecute. But most of these offences take place in remote areas where there are not there are no people to see them. So it's very easy to hide this. And we have hardly any cases of somebody killing a bird of prey being actually witnessed. There are a number of cases filmed, but you can appreciate how difficult it is to do that. And the important thing is that we can use circumstantial and other kinds of indirect evidence to indicate the scale of this killing.
So could I ask if you think the current scope of relevant offences is proportionate then, given the lack of...
The current one of relevant offences. Yes, yeah. The difficulty is in getting a prosecution under criminal legislation.
If I may, yeah. I think that there's a choice to be made here in these situations. You're trying to identify offences which suggest that somebody is not appropriate to hold a licence. And you can approach that from a very narrow approach, that all you are doing, looking at, is their conduct in exactly the same area of activity, which would be very narrowly confined. Or you can say, well, this form of behaviour is reflected, is shown by the way people react in other situations. And if you think about all sorts of other areas where licensing is involved, there are considerations. Do we look just at what is, if you take, for example, I'm trying to think of an example. I know this has arisen in relation to firearms offences. Do you look, if you're deciding to not to give somebody a licence, do you look only at the way they've behaved in relation to firearms? Or do you look at other forms of behaviour that suggest that they're not to be trusted, they're unreliable, and so on? And that's a policy choice to be made. That list could be a lot shorter, it could be a lot longer, and you could make cogent arguments both ways.
Okay.
Jim Fairley.
Yeah. Is that one?
Mm-hmm. Just now.
Oh, right. Thank you, Convener. I'm just keen to explore a wee bit further the range of relevant offences. I mean, it includes Part 1 of the Wildlife and Countryside Act, protection of badgers, Conservation Part C, the Conservation Natural Regulations Act, Section 1 of the Wild Mammals Protection Act, Hunting with Dogs Scotland Act 2023. It includes all of these things in the bill. Given that your review was specifically looking at raptor persecution, do you believe that including all of these things is proportionate in taking this bill forward?
Well, I'd say that our remit wasn't just to look at raptor persecution, it was to look at grouse moor management more widely. And one of the points we made in the report is the need to look at this in a wider context. Don't think it's sensible to fragment the different bits too much. And the offences in there are ones that could be seen as generally, people who commit those offences are generally showing an attitude and approach, a willingness to behave in relation to the natural environment in a way that is in line with the things we're trying to stop, that the bill is trying to stop in terms of the legislation. If you see this measure as being purely about raptor persecution on grouse moors, then that's taking a very, I would say, an excessively narrow view of what this bill, what our review was trying to look at. Indeed, one of my regrets is that the bill as it's coming forward, despite the time since we haven't seen the wider review of the context of upland management we'd have hoped for, integrating the outcome of the deer review, the legislation that's coming to that. We'd hoped that by now you'd have hoped that the post-Brexit rural support systems would be clearer, what's happening in relation to carbon management and so on in the uplands areas. Looking at any one bit in isolation is a danger. But as I say, in terms of this particular issue, you could say, right, we're going to have a very narrow approach and say only the immediately involved offences, activities, are the ones that are going to be deemed as relevant here. Or I say you could have a much wider one, that anybody who's shown a disregard for the elements of the natural environment we value, that should be enough to be relevant for these purposes.
OK, thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
There's quite a number of points that you've made there, Professor Reid. I mean, I just want to clarify some of them. So within the Werity report itself, are you saying that what the Scottish Government have done in the shaping of the bill is actually broaden what you had recommended in terms of the scope of triggering a licence for suspension and revocation? And I mean, I would like to explore what Werity believed was the causal link between raptor persecution and grouse moors themselves.
On the first issue, I don't think that is the case. We were asked to look at this widely. We expressly did not look at the details of a licensing scheme because we are so much aware of issues such as this, an issue we may come to, the duration of licences and so on. We very consciously, we identified a number of issues that would have to be thought about, but we did not explore those in detail and consciously left them for this next stage, knowing that there were sensible, there could be a range of options, all of which would be reasonable in working through the details. So we didn't do that. But in terms of what I'm saying in terms of the breadth is that we weren't just, raptor persecution was the trigger for setting up the review, but it wasn't the only thing we were asked to look at.
So I suppose the point is, what has been shaped by the government covers a broader range of crimes.
Yeah, the list, what they has been identified as being relevant indicators of somebody of putting a licence at risk captures a range of behaviours in relation to the natural environment, not just raptor persecution.
And as part of the Werity review, do you also believe that, you know, the question has been asked by both of my colleagues about proportionality? Do you have any comment with regards to the recommendations that you made specifically about the proportionality?
We did not get into that issue because we didn't work through the details of a licensing scheme. You know, we'd recognise that you could design a licensing scheme that would be wholly disproportionate. You could describe a very light touch one that would have absolutely no problems in passing any test or any legal or political sense of proportionality. So it's a question of exactly the balance has to be looked at. And in looking at the issue of proportionality, you have to look at the legislative package as a whole. You know, what are the tests for getting or intervening? What are the appeal mechanisms? What are the procedures? What are the sanctions available? It's very much a package rather than identifying one particular measure as being in isolation.
Yeah, and I mean, to press you on the licensing scheme itself, Professor Reid, I was on the committee that looked at this originally back in the day, I read through the papers, and you said we want to see a licensing scheme that is more flexible and responsive than a black and white scheme whereby you have to apply every year to get a licence. But 16AA 5B provides that licences be granted for a maximum of 1 year. So in that sense, with regards to what you said at that committee session, would the scheme be improved if licences were granted for a longer period?
My personal view is yes. I think that annual licence, given that the activities affected are long-term management of the land, given that businesses have an expectation to be able to plan ahead, I think annual licences are unnecessary. I think that a longer-term licence, subject to the point that the licences can be amended, suspended and so on. It's this idea of the whole package, that if once a licence was granted, you could do very little afterwards. There's a stronger case for having annual licences, because that would be the only way, the annual renewal would be the only way of keeping an eye on things, changing things, affecting things. Given that the bill is providing quite wide powers for the ministers or Nature Scott to modify a licence, to suspend it, to revoke and so on, then I think that having annual renewal is probably unnecessary.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Your own review rather, recommended Scottish Natural Heritage, or as it now is Nature Scott, as the body, the licensing authority. I just wonder if the bill that we're looking at now allows for a scheme that you still feel Nature Scott are in a position to deliver.
I think Nature Scott is the obvious body to undertake this regulatory function. I can't think of another public body who could take that on board. They do currently operate a general licensing scheme, so they have experience in managing licences. I very much concur with what Professor Reid has just said. In my personal view, I think licences up to 5 years on a rolling basis would be welcomed. I am sensitive to the concern about the bureaucracy and the costs which are involved, so I think it should be as light touch as is commensurate with effective delivery of regulation. Perhaps I should point out the nature of the remit which we had as a review, because we've been focusing entirely on licensing thus far. Licensing was only one of the possible options which we explored. And given the wide-ranging nature of our review, which was to look at the more sustainable management of grass moors in the round, we did not zero in on licensing in great detail, anticipating, as Professor Reid has said, that should this come to this stage where legislation was being proposed, a whole set of new questions would emerge, hence your questioning. But our review was very wide-ranging and perhaps triggered a number of quite separate conversations and discussions.
And without second-guessing what SNH or Nature Scott might now do, I just wonder if you had, Professor Werrity, any views about what the choices are they face in terms of licensing. You mentioned it should be light touch. I mean, what's the scope of options that you feel they should be considering?
I think they will build on their experience of operating general licences, which they've done for a number of years now. I have confidence that they have the professional capacity to undertake this. And as a public body, they clearly need to be concerned about public perception of how they operate. So if they were to be unduly heavy-handed, this would not serve them well. They have to negotiate, I think, an understanding with landowners. The vast majority of grouse moors are well managed. We are looking at a very small minority where raptor persecution is a major concern. So I think with goodwill on both sides, they can negotiate a system which is effective but not unduly onerous.
Thank you.
Just on that, on the light touch that we've heard, Professor Reid, you said back in 2020 that licences should more or less automatically be approved. Do you believe that the licence application tests at section S16AA1 and 2, how do they compare to that vision that you had on the light touch? And could what we've got in the bill at the moment be improved?
Bills can always be improved, however, whatever they are. I think there, in any licensing scheme, there is a choice to be made between rigidity, which gives you clarity and certainty, and flexibility, which inevitably involves a degree of discretion and uncertainty. The choices that have been made here are not to have a particularly rigid system where there are, as a checklist, you do this exactly and you get a licence, fail to do it exactly and you don't get a licence, or you get your licence taken away or suspended or whatever. So that, in an area where the scientific evidence is uncertain, where the scientific evidence is changing, where the natural environment is always changing, where you're dealing with a vast range of size, scale and nature of enterprises doing the business, I think that a flexible system is almost inevitable and is the best way to have a fair and proportionate way of operating a licence system, because any other thing else, you'd have to have rigid tests that would mean one size wouldn't fit all, and certainly wouldn't fit all with the changing climate, the changing environment, the changing understanding of the natural environment, the changing pressures on it. So, yes, I can quite understand why some people are concerned about the uncertainty of this, the breadth of the test, the fact it's not fully defined. But the alternative of having something much, much clearer, I think, would have equal, if not more, problems. And as Professor Werity has said, we're relying on a public authority that is subject to internal controls, subject to appeals, subject to external controls and ultimately ministerial control to make sure that it operates the system in a sensible and proportionate way.
Yeah, because given the gravity of the consequences of losing a licence and the other legislation in place, as we've heard, the Wildlife and Country Act in 1981, the Badgers Act and so on, is there the safeguards within the legislation at the moment to make sure we don't see the potentially the gravity of losing a licence on what could be a minor offence? We've got the flexibility, but the safeguards.
The safeguard, the appeal mechanism that's provided provides a safeguard. There's also the potential for judicial review eventually, ministerial control, the ombudsman, but it's always a matter of choice. Unless you're going to have an absolutely checklist system that's black and white and have items on the checklist that you can absolutely prove one way or another, there's going to have to be flexibility, and that means giving discretion to public authorities. But our entire public administration system depends on discretion in the hands of licensing bodies, government grant awarding bodies and so on. It's remarkably few situations where you're absolutely entitled to certain licences and so on. There's always an element of discretion.
OK. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Professor Werity, coming back to the point that you made, the debate has definitely started, has kind of focused very narrowly in on this is about licensing grouse moors, and clearly your report is much wider than that. Can I ask, I think you considered at some point the power to impose fines on grouse moors managers in the same way as SEPA would have the ability to impose fines. Was that in addition to, or was that as a separate thing to licensing? Were they two different things, or did you think that both of them would work together?
In addition to the review group, I had four special advisers assisting me, and one of those was a senior official from SEPA who manages their regulatory controls on, particularly on discharges into water bodies. Mm. And it was picking up on how they operate that I thought there might be an analogous situation in terms of licensing grouse moors. SEPA issues permits to discharge into watercourses, controlled in terms of the specified pollutant or whatever which is going into the watercourse, and has the ability to monitor that, and then charges a fee for so doing. Mm. I was particularly picking up the point that there is income recovery for SEPA from this activity, and I noticed that in the bill, as currently drafted, there is no mechanism for recovery cost by NatureScot. My understanding is that NatureScot at the moment does not seek to recover the costs of issuing licences. I wonder if it would be wise to revisit that following CEPA's experience. My concern here is that, at the end of the day, compliance is crucial to the success of this whole enterprise, and one has to monitor that compliance. Mm. And if NatureScot doesn't have the resources, either by gathering a fee from a licence or from an increase in its government grant, I'm very concerned that CEPA may not be able to monitor the performance of this bill should it become an act in an effective manner. That was the context with which I thought the CEPA experience might be an interesting one.
Okay. And correct me if I'm wrong, I may be misinterpreting and misunderstanding you here. If you were going to fine somebody because they had done something on their grouse moor or on their land which would be subject to a fine, you would need a burden of proof to do that.
Yeah.
Given that the licensing scheme has got a potential for the investigation to have the license suspended, does the fine element of it not make it a lot harder to actually retrieve any money, and would there actually be more cost in trying to get the burden of proof to a level where a fine could be imposed?
I don't quite follow you.
If I could come in, I think...
I'm possibly misunderstanding...
There are several different issues going on here. The Regulatory Reform Scotland Act has created a system of what was generally known as civil penalties, civil sanctions, so that when somebody has a licence, one of the responses to discovering a breach can be to use the powers, as in this bill, to suspend or revoke the licence or modify it so that you put extra conditions that make behaviour in future different. In some areas of environmental and other law, the regulatory body has the power itself to impose a fine, either a fixed fine or a variable fine, or to take an enforcement undertaking. There's this whole range of sanctions that are provided for in the Regulatory Reform Act. Mm-hmm. These aren't being copied here. It may be a question whether they should be. But for those, as you say, there still has to be a question of proof. The Scottish legislation has generally used the civil burden of proof as the basis for imposing fines, but as always subject to appeals and later controls. So one option within this bill would be that NatureScot or the ministers, rather than when they find things are going wrong, rather than being forced, well, do we suspend or revoke the licence, knowing the major consequences that's going to have to the state, to the enterprise, doing it, could we impose a penalty? And then the question, you're then faced with the further questions, well, for what sort of breaches is this appropriate for what sort of breaches? And again, you'll have endless arguments over these things. So I'm sorry if I'm sounding very uncertain about this, but there is, you know, in designing a regulatory scheme, there are all these choices to be made, and trying to think about all the circumstances that are going to be relevant, what's going to make sense, what's going to be practical, and how the different bits fit together is, you know, it is complicated, and there's never going to be one right answer. There are going to be, you know, plenty of scope for argument on all the different bits and how they fit together.
Yeah, you've definitely added more questions than answers.
I'm sorry, but that's the...
Thank you.
That's the job on this side of the table.
I think this will be the last one for a few moments on licensing. Rachel Hamilton.
Well, it's on the suspension of licences, so I just need to get some clarity. You explained pretty well there, Professor Reid, but in terms of the powers that are proposed in the bill for NatureScot to suspend licences, even if they're not satisfied to the civil burden of proof that an offence has been committed. And, of course, there will be an official investigation into an offence and to the person that has been accused of committing an offence. But what are your observations on that particular section, 16AA, if you've had an opportunity to look at it? And would you consider that proposal was a lower evidential bar to suspension than the Werity report had envisaged?
We didn't get to the detail of envisaging what the bar for different interventions would be. I can see why that provision is in there. It's to enable interim quick action to be taken where there is you don't perhaps have a complete case, but there is strong indicative evidence. And that may be useful in some. It is, of course, a power that only may be exercised. I mean, I can't imagine it would happen in many circumstances at all. But it is there to cover the situation where, because either formal investigations take a long time, certainly getting to the stage of a prosecution takes a long time, there may be thought to be a desire to intervene more rapidly than is possible. I would see it as a fairly strong power that I would envisage being used very, very rarely, if at all.
And stakeholders in the previous session had said that, going back to the appeal, that the appeal could take a long time. It could take up to a year.
Yeah.
So, again, from your vision of how this was to be shaped, would you consider that sheriff should have discretionary power, to decide that a penalty imposed by Nature Scott is of no effect pending determination of the appeal?
That is a provision which appears in several environmental licensing schemes. It's either the question is which danger do you think is greater? And evidence, not in relation to grouse moors, but in other areas, have been that in circumstances where sanctions are put in abeyance during an appeal process, that appeal process has in some areas been seriously abused by people dragging out the appeal process as long as possible to make sure that the sanction isn't actually imposed on them. So the public interest suffers that way. If you make it the other way, then the private interest suffers because the person who's subject to the sanction goes. And again, it's this question of who do you trust? How are you going to have the balances? I would expect that the length of time, the difficulties of appeal, is something that Nature Scott and the ministers would take into account in deciding whether they were justified in suspending a licence during an investigation rather than beforehand. And I see it as a very extreme power that I can't imagine being used.
Just a quick last point on that. I just wondered if you think that an investigation should be triggered by a vexatious allegation, or should be triggered?
If a investigation is triggered by something that isn't incredibly strong evidence, I can't imagine the ministers or Nature Scott deciding that that's a basis for suspending a licence, because the whole point of the investigation is to find out whether something is going wrong, and the decision to suspend, I would totally expect, will be taken because there are things going wrong. We need to act immediately. And if there's not a strongly, if it is a single, possibly vexatious complaint, I don't see how SNH could come reasonably to the decision that we need to take the strong action immediately.
Okay.
So I accept the concern, having read the previous evidence session, I accept the concerns that there aren't the absolute written guarantees. But that's inevitable unless you're going to have an incredibly fixed, rigid system that can't respond to changing circumstances, that can't respond to situations where there may be real problems. You can't respond quickly to situations where there are real problems.
Yeah, thank you. I think where the difficulty lies is whether there are serious allegations or serious evidence, and on what basis then can a licence be suspended. That's the difficulty, and as you say, the safeguards around that. We're going to move on. We've now got a question for Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose in focusing here on the licensing system, what we haven't really allowed you to do is to explain why you came to the conclusions you did in terms of the abuses that you felt it was necessary to legislate to fix. You've mentioned that the vast majority of the states operate responsibly. But what was the evidence that led you to conclude that there was a need for instance, a code of practice? What were the incidents, what were the evidence, if you can give us a flavour of, that drew you to the conclusion a code of practice was necessary?
Well, the main issue, of course, in grouse management was the illegal killing of valued birds of prey. and most other measures that might reduce this persecution have been tried in the past nationwide over the past 6 or 7 decades, and yet the practice still persists. So at that stage, licensing provided the next potentially big deterrent to this. It's the penultimate measure, if you like, the ultimate measure being banning grouse shooting altogether, which we didn't want to get to that stage. This was the only situation, or the next situation, open to us. It also, we felt, with licensing, that it would raise the profile of the activity, both to the applicant and the general public, and provide some reassurance to concerned members of the public that grouse shooting activities are being taken seriously. Some of these members of the public would otherwise call for the banning of grouse shooting, which we didn't want to happen. And the other advantage of a licensing system we've already covered, I think, that the current penalties rest on criminal convictions, which are almost impossible to obtain. But licensing opened up the possibility of taking much more account of circumstantial evidence and introducing a number of penalties or sanctions of varying severity, ultimately leading to suspension or revocation. And by acting largely on circumstantial evidence, penalties would move us from the criminal burden of proof to civil burden of proof. But even though a licence might be offered for, let's say, 3 to 5 year period, it would provide an opportunity for Nature Scot to ask for annual information on such things as the number of animals killed, what sort of animals were killed, and so on, associated with grouse shooting, both the bag sizes, the numbers of hares, the numbers of predators, and so on, and give Nature Scot an opportunity to learn more about what happens on grouse moors and how it proceeds. I mean, most major land uses, annual statistics are available. For example, for forestry, on the number of hectares that are planted each year, the kinds of trees that are planted, that's readily available. For agriculture, we have the information on the crops that are grown, and so on. But for grouse shooting, there is absolutely no evidence that is fed into a central government on anything that happens there. So that seemed a way of filling that gap at no major cost to landowners, but would be useful for Nature Scot to monitor the situation, the animals that are being killed, to become alerted to any expected changes and follow population trends. So it fills an important evidence gap in land use in Scotland. So for those various reasons, we were persuaded after a lot of discussion that licensing was a sensible option.
Thank you.
May I just interject for a moment? One of the most striking findings, which perhaps isn't as self-evident as it ought to be from our report, was that our key recommendation was that, subject to the trend in raptor numbers over a period of 5 years, if it continued to deteriorate, then we actually recommended licensing. And that was a unanimous recommendation by the whole group, which included two members effectively representing the grouse shooting sector. I imply from that that there is a willingness across Scotland to regard licensing as an appropriate way forward when, in a sense, everything else has failed. And I think that's where we feel we've got to. We did look at a number of alternatives. We looked at self-regulation. It hasn't worked. We looked at accreditation schemes. We looked at financial incentives, which might be introduced. We looked at a whole range of alternatives. We did not lightly descend on licensing immediately as the way forward. Effectively, we set up a whole range of options, explored them in some detail, and you can see that in our report, and we came to licensing because we thought it was the only credible way forward. And that was agreed by all members of the review group, including those who arguably represented the shooting interest.
Thank you. Don't know if you want to add anything, Professor Reid?
No. Just as an example, are you satisfied the Code of Conduct deals with the recommendations on the review of medical grit?
Yes, medical grit was an interesting area for us to explore. Our recommendation was for a voluntary code for that one, rather than a legally binding or statutory code. Our concerns there were really twofold. One was concerned the administration of medicated grit, and in particular the recommendation that it be withdrawn at a fixed period in the year to prevent it potentially entering the food chain. And we were somewhat concerned about the engagement of estates with the veterinary profession to ensure that the administration was being done to the highest possible standard. There were also some concerns about leaching of the chemical attached to the medicated grit into watercourses. And CEPA, whilst they could not give us any clear indication as to whether this was potentially inimical, they were concerned that, again, some degree of regulation through a voluntary code of practice could perhaps improve the way in which medicated grit was used. There was no suggestion that medicated grit should be withdrawn. We could see that it was a crucial element in the in the business model of grass moor management. But we felt a voluntary code of practice bringing up all the estates to best practice would be valuable in both those respects.
Thank you very much. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you all. It's interesting to hear that, you know, this isn't just about the management of grouse. There is, Convener's brought up the issues of medical grit, and then we've heard about raptors as well. So just to confirm that if we introduced a licensing scheme, that would be the optimal way to be able to manage grouse moors and track what's happening and be able to collect data. And I suppose I'm looking at Professor Newton, because that's what you've said as far as this is the only way forward in order to be able to manage or be able to trace what's happening, rather than just have a voluntary code of practice.
Mm-hmm. So what was the question specifically?
So specifically, it's is the optimal way forward introducing a licensing scheme?
Yes, well, the other, as we said, the various other methods that we could use have really not worked, and we're driven to this position of licensing because the others haven't worked. But introducing licences brings us other advantages as well, which I outlined, particularly this central acquisition of important data on what's happening on a major area of land on which at the moment we have little or no information.
One of the most striking things we discovered in our review was that the science base is heavily contested between experts on one hand, peer-reviewed journals publishing their findings in the international literature, and what one could call local vernacular knowledge arising from gamekeepers and land managers. Enormous antipathy between evidence in those two arenas. And one of the things that I think will be valuable from the outcome of this legislation is that we will begin to develop a more credible science base across the whole area of moorland management. What is very striking is how little we know in detail, robustly, about the way the natural environment of a grouse moor operates. We'll probably come on to Muirburn in due course. The Muirburn literature is full of enormous contradictions and uncertainty. As Professor Newton has said, if we can actually assemble a much richer database as a result of this as an ancillary benefit, that will advance the science. And there's then a virtuous loop that can inform adjustments to the regulatory system. So we can begin to tweak the regulatory system as the science becomes more secure and more firmly attested.
OK, thank you. Thanks.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for being with us this morning already. So much good information coming from your experience. And you're already beginning to touch on what I wanted to get into here, which is around the bigger picture in relation to land management and grass moor. So identifying the fact that we could actually start to create that credible science base there and understand what's really going on. I'd be interested to hear what you think is the potential for sustainable grassborough management in terms of a contribution to tackling the crisis, the climate and biodiversity crisis. Do you think that this bill could support that?
Yes, I think indirectly it could move us in the right direction. Professor Newton will be able to speak with more authority on bird ecology and the significance that the appropriate management of moorland for promoting appropriate habitat for birds. The question of carbon budgets and carbon sequestration in particularly those parts of grassmoors which have a very thick peat layer, I'm sure we'll come on to in a moment. There is clearly a contribution that can be made in terms of the climate crisis in how we manage muir burn and its interaction with wildfires and so on. Perhaps I could invite Professor Newton to address the ecological aspects of your question.
Yeah, well, grouse moor is a fairly unique habitat, and it does support a number of birds that are relatively rare and international standards. And also the predator control on grouse moors, of course, a lot of predators can be legally controlled there. That does mean that the species that nest there generally nest with good success. They can maintain their populations, and that's not necessarily the case in many other areas. Many other parts of Scotland or Britain in general. So certain species can maintain themselves on grouse moors at densities that wouldn't be possible in the rest of Britain and sustain their populations in the long term. So many species are now declining in Britain as a whole, but one of the areas where they're maintaining themselves is on grouse moors because of the management. So there's a lot to be said for that. And a few years ago, in an exercise I did, I was really looking at the environmental impacts of different major land uses in the uplands of Britain, not just Scotland, but England as a whole. And with grouse moors, if you left aside the raptor issue, they were environmentally the least damaging of all the major land uses. Forestry, for example, had destroyed much more peatland than grouse moors have ever done. They've also been responsible for a lot of acidification of landscapes, which puts them in a totally different field to grouse moors. Agriculture in the uplands with huge densities of sheep and so on had a huge impact over a period of several decades in changing upland vegetation, mostly to species of plants that sheep didn't like to eat, and also causing a lot of erosion and soil compaction and so on. So if you looked at the different land uses, the one that had caused the least damage was managed heather moorland for grouse, apart from the raptor issue. If you take the raptors out, it stood very good, and the birds that lived there were able to sustain good populations. It's becoming increasingly important as an area for maintaining ground nesting open land birds as general predators in the countryside like foxes and so on increase in Britain as a whole, which have tipped a lot of bird species into decline, but grouse moors are one of the areas where that's not happened. So we have no interest in reducing the area of grouse moors at all.
Thanks for that. I just want to come back to a bit more on the code of practice, and I just wondered, I really am interested in the idea that you're looking at that scientific base and that kind of bigger picture. And I wondered if you looked into the issue of lead shot being used. And I realise that's being phased out, but historically, what I'm aware of in parts of my region is that lead shot gets shot on maybe what is a grouse moor, but ends up being shot into trees on neighbouring land. And I just wonder if there's any understanding of that kind of issue. You talked about the problems of the chemical grit running, the chemical grit running into the watercourse. But I wonder if we've looked into the lead running into our seeping into our ground and our watercourses.
I don't know of any research specifically relating to grouse moors, but obviously lead shot has been tipped onto grouse moors now for well over a century or so. And one thing that several people have commented to me is that if you get a grouse and you cut it open, very often they've got bits of lead shot in their crop. Well, grouse, like a lot of other herbivorous birds, they pick up bits of grit and swallow grit to help with food digestion. And the assumption is that they pick up little bits of lead shot in mistake for grit, if we can put it that way. So they are being contaminated indirectly, as a lot of other birds are in Britain. But I wouldn't say that lead shot is more used on grouse moors than it is on any other areas where game are shot. There's just a general problem to reduce the use and preferably eliminate the use of lead shot in Britain. It's the last remaining use of lead that the public are still exposed to that we could so easily remove.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Just following on from Ariane's question in there, when we're looking at the full potential of what the grouse moors could do to support biodiversity and climate change, as you mentioned, does this bill support that full potential or does it not?
It's clearly not a primary driver for the proposed legislation. So I guess one has to say, is it supporting other initiatives which the Scottish Government is developing as we deal with the climate and nature emergency? As Professor Newton has just said, I think on the biodiversity side of things, he's just argued very cogently that it is a positive contribution to sustaining the current level of biodiversity and not allowing it to deteriorate further. In terms of climate change, it is a much more mixed picture. When we come to Muirburn, as I said earlier, the literature is incredibly confused. I don't know whether you have had access to a recent SNH report published in 2022, which was a meta-analysis of all the literature on Muirburn. And I think the single most important takeaway message was we know so little about the impact of Muirburn in terms of carbon budgets, in terms of its impact on wildfire, in terms of fluxes, greenhouse gas fluxes. And so in terms of the precautionary principle, which we've mentioned on a number of occasions, I think given the lack of clear scientific evidence, we need to proceed circumspectly in terms of Muirburn. And I feel that the regulation which is proposed for Muirburn, which takes the current system, which relates to a piece of legislation passed in 1949 and we discovered was no longer fit for purpose, I think a statutory code on Muirburn with all the regulations implicit within it will provide us with a very positive way forward. And again, I would like to emphasise a point which we very much reflected upon in our report, this notion of adaptive management, that you can, and it goes back to what Professor Reid was saying earlier about the need to provide some wiggle room within the legislation, not to make it unduly prescriptive, because as the science base develops, and I would emphasise that the science base underpinning a lot of moorland management is incredibly fragmented, contested and incomplete. As that begins the gaps begin to be filled in, then we can tighten up some of the regulatory models and adjust and move forward in a way that I think could be beneficial for both climate change and protecting biodiversity.
That's helpful. Can I just come back in? So I don't want to put words in your mouth, but could we see this bill, more than looking at a full prescription, because we don't have the full picture, it would be more a vehicle as well to get that full picture?
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
Thank you.
Two very short supplementaries, Rachel Hamilton and Jim Fairley.
I'll try and keep it very brief. Do you think that, Professor Warity, do you think that the socio-economic impact of grouse moor licensing has been assessed adequately in this process, bearing in mind that there was no direct or indirect engagement with businesses as part of the BREEA?
Yes, this was one of the major challenges which we had in our remit when the then Cabinet Secretary invited me to take on this review. one of the key elements of the remit was to have regard to the socio-economic impact of any measures in terms of our recommendations. We did not have either the capacity or the focus to drill down deeply into that area. We did rely on work done by a separate investigation, which was commissioned by the Scottish Government. The numbers are in our report. I think I'm just looking for the numbers here. I think if I remember, the grouse sector currently supports about 2,500 full-time jobs and generates over £24,000 of gross added value. So there is a very significant contribution which grouse farm management makes, particularly to the rural economy. Given that were there to be a ban, let's take that as the most draconian measure on grouse shooting, that would have an incredibly adverse impact, I think, locally on the rural economy. And therefore, in our recommendations, we are seeking to protect those jobs and those interests, but encouraging estates which are not demonstrating best practice in terms of how they're managed to achieve that level of performance.
I just understand this. But
we've sort of jumped. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to bring back Jim for his supplementary on where we were previously and then go back to the socio-economic topic. So, Jim, if you'd like to come in with your questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. Professor Newton, I'm going to come back to you. Just something that struck me when you were talking there about the predator control and the effect that that will have on particular species of orange red list ground nesters. Are you saying that the management in a grouse moor is helping to sustain those red list type birds, golden plover, red shank, stuff like that, snipe? Yeah, are they in better health on grouse moors than they are on unmanaged places? Is that the point that you're making?
That's exactly the point I'm making. Yeah, the populations, as far as we can judge, for the most part, are good and self-sustaining on grouse moor areas, whereas elsewhere, in most areas elsewhere, not everywhere, I can't speak for everywhere, but in most other areas, they're declining, and they're declining mainly because they're not producing enough young to offset the usual mortality rate. And most of that poor reproduction, at least on the uplands, is due to predation.
Okay.
On the lowlands, you also have agriculture. But
is it predation across the board, mammals, and particularly corvids? Corvids are particularly good at finding eggs.
Well, all the ones that take bird eggs or young chicks, which are the corvids, foxes and mustelids like stoats, they're probably the main ones, and badgers in some areas.
Great. Thank you.
Do you want to continue with exploring rural businesses and ECHR considerations?
Yes. Professor Uwereke, do you have any concerns that have been raised by some stakeholders that the provisions in the bill on licensing may not be compliant with the European Convention of Human Rights? For example, due to the potential of a disproportionate interference with property rights?
I defer to Professor Reid for this one.
Any time you're interfering with businesses and property rights, potentially, you're falling foul. The question is it a proportionate interference? And there are various elements to that. One is the reason for which you're interfering a legitimate one? And the European Court of Human Rights, our own legislation, made it clear that environmental protection is a legitimate reason for interfering. So you get through that first, over that first threshold. The question then is whether the detail of the interference is proportionate or not. And that brings us back to the discussion we've had earlier about the precise details of the licensing scheme and how it operates. And the fact that if the legislation were wide enough to allow a very extreme, strict, harsh intervention that would fall foul, just because the legislation allows that to happen doesn't mean the legislation itself falls foul of the convention. It's a question of how it's operated in practice. Mm. And that means looking at the legal tests, how they're operated, how those operate with the various controls, redress mechanisms, and so on. So the legislation as drafted just now, I can see operating in a way that would be perfectly compliant with the European Convention. I can also see it being operated by a rogue Nature Scot or a rogue minister in a way that would cause severe problems with it. I don't think that imposing the requirement for a licence in itself is going to fall foul of the Convention unless the hoops you have to go through to get a licence are absolutely absurd.
Well, let's presume that the hoops are dead easy.
Yeah.
You just apply for the licence and you get it.
Yeah.
At what point would the licence then, if you're saying with, I think what you're saying was a heavy-handed Nature Scot person imposing certain restrictions, at what point does that then breach European Court of Human Rights, European Convention on Human Rights?
Sadly, the answer is when it's disproportionate. And that so would look at, that would look at, if, say, that the, if the code, I'm trying to think of an absurd example. Say the code of practice recommended people didn't wear sunglasses when out shooting because it affected their visibility. And it was found that on one occasion, one member of a shooting party had worn sunglasses. And the result was your licence is being revoked.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that would be a clearly absurd use of it.
Can I put one further? Is that okay? Can put one further example that has been put to me as a former sheep farmer.
Yep.
I may have had the desire to shoot a white-tailed eagle because it was lifting lambs, and I would be fined, possibly imprisoned, and I would face the full force of the law, whatever that happened to be. But I wouldn't be stopped from farming sheep. So, if I'm a grousemoor manager and I do something and the licence is removed, I am then effectively being stopped from carrying out my way of making a living.
Yep.
Would that fall into the European Court of the European Convention on Human Rights?
I think I could almost guarantee that would go to the courts, and you never guarantee what the result would be. I don't think that, although you would be stopped from grouse shooting, A, it would only be stopped for a time, you wouldn't be necessarily a lifetime ban, and the question would be, well, is there, are there other uses of the land, land at all? I'm afraid, I'm sorry, I apologise for all the lawyers, that, you know, proportionality is by its definition a rather vague test, and it is a question of looking at all the factors and weighing the public interest factors, the private interest factors together, and allowing regulatory bodies an element of discretion.
So this is going to be interesting.
I can imagine if you can keep thinking, life will throw up an endless range of circumstances, some of which will be absolutely in the grey area and exactly the sort of thing we try to think up when making problems for the students to get them to answer this way or that, and without really caring what the answer is, because it's the argument that, from our, as a teacher, is what you're interested in.
Grand. Thank you.
I'm very conscious of time, and I would like to go into wildlife traps, but I've got a brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Very generous of you, thank you. Page 16 of the BREA, just going back to my original question there, Professor Werity, states that the Scottish Government have not consulted on the impact of licensing, either directly or indirectly, on businesses. Now, bearing in mind what you just said about the challenges around determining the socio-economic impact of grousemoor licensing, would you have expected the Scottish Government to have done that as part of the BREA?
Speaking purely personally, that would seem to me to be something that they should have done. This whole area is problematic because we know so little about the socio-economic impact of grousemoor management. As I mentioned earlier, the Scottish Government did commission a separate study. That study, I have to say, was imperfect in a number of ways. Not least because of the challenge of obtaining the appropriate data. For very obvious reasons, there's elements of commercial confidentiality. It is, in fact, very difficult to drill down into the socioeconomics of grousemoor management. So I think there's a bit of an impasse here. We don't know really in detail very much about the socioeconomic impact of grousemoor management, and clearly, if the bill is to be well informed and well evidence based, we do need to get that additional information. And I'm not sure how that comes about. It was one of the frustrations of my review that this area, which we were charged to give due regard to, was very problematic because the evidence simply is not in the public domain, other than that separate report which I mentioned earlier, but which I think we found imperfect.
Thank you.
Thank you. But as I say, we're now going to move on to wildlife traps. Quid from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Can I just ask if you can explain a bit about how you came to the conclusion that there was a need for a new regulation around wildlife traps, and are you satisfied with what the bill has done in terms of making your recommendations real?
Professor Reid, to speak on this one.
I mean, trapping and snaring, we know, is a long-running controversial issue. There are problems with the misuse of traps. By introducing a licensing system, the hope is that the professionalism of many gamekeepers, land managers, will be recognised. They will have the reassurance that they can defend themselves. They are, in speaking to the public, they say, we are doing it the proper way, it's been properly assessed, using the relevant traps in the relevant way, and so on. It's the law on trapping and snaring has been a bit of a mess because it's been rather inconsistent, so anything that tries to, you know, make it simpler by drawing things together. I think the experience has been that the requirement for training, the requirement for visiting traps and snares has reduced the problems with misuse, problems with animal cruelty, and it seems sensible to try to have greater consistency, greater controls to make sure the abuse isn't happening, as I say, while giving this form of reassurance that professionally operated traps or traps can be used.
Does anyone else wish to come in on these issues? No. Can I ask about numbered traps? Is this something that you can say anything about?
We didn't look at the details of that. I've seen the various evidence on that both ways, that it's obviously clearly incredibly helpful to be able to identify who's responsible. For some of you, we drive cars that have got license plates. We know who's responsible for a motor vehicle, therefore, who has to take it. On the other hand, I accept I can understand the fears of some of those in the industry that it, you know, may lead to identification of personal people and harassment.
Thank you, Camilla.
Just given the grave consequences of the inappropriate or the illegal use of traps, again, we're looking at the consequences of potentially losing a licence or whatever. Do you think the concerns we've heard from land managers are well-founded and that there should be a specific piece of legislation surrounding tampering with traps to ensure that we don't get, again, vexatious claims where someone with the wrong intent could take a tagged trap, set it in a legal manner, and then call the police, which could result in the loss of a licence? What's your views on a specific new criminal act regarding traps?
The activity like that would already be criminal under malicious mischief or possibly vandalism. So it's a question of whether it merits a separate crime. And this is again, another long-standing issue in many areas of law. There is a value in having a specific crime that signals a particular form of behaviour is unacceptable. On the other hand, you then end up having endless layer upon layer of crime, which actually makes it harder to understand what's going on, harder to enforce, and so on. You know, in one sense, almost, you know, about half the crime in Scotland could possibly just be dealt with as breach of the peace.
Yeah.
But we want to have separate named crimes doing different things for a variety of reasons. So in a session, it's a question about whether it's thought that the public signal of having the specific named offence is important enough to justify something that is already criminal. I mean, there are lots of examples of activities that are already criminal where another crime is put on top for policy, public signalling reasons. And depending on your views, that's either a helpful, useful function for the Parliament or it's simply creating unnecessary complication.
Yeah, so do you think that and I'm not going to repeat the law that you just stated, that yeah, people who tamper with traps might be convicted of, there's a very low rate of convictions using that yeah piece of legislation. Do you think, from what you say, it would appear that potentially a specific law relating to tampering with traps may have a positive effect?
I'm not convinced it would, because you're going to hit exactly the same problems as with raptor persecution in terms of gathering the evidence. The suggestions are that the number of reported wildlife offences is a lot lower than the number that occur in reality. I'm sure the same exists in relation to tampering. Certainly some of the evidence I've heard in other contexts, not in the Wherryshire Review, is that gamekeepers, landowners tell people this is happening, but they don't report it to the police. If they do report it to police, you then have exactly the same problems of finding the evidence beyond reasonable doubt in rural, remote areas.
OK. Rachel Hamilton, then Jim Fairley.
I don't have a question just now.
Jim Fairley.
You'll ask me as well.
OK. That's grand. We'll move on to Muirburn. And we have questions from Rhoda Grant.
You talked earlier about the science around Muirburn and whether or not it was beneficial or not and what was the impact. So just to ask why you came then to the conclusion that it should be subject to increased legal regulation?
The current system is a voluntary code, and our experience was that the voluntary code is not working. We had evidence presented, particularly in the Cairngorms National Park, of wildfires that could be associated with Muirburn out of control. So I think our starting point was the current system is broken. We need to move from a voluntary code to a statutory code. Regulated and well-conducted Muirburn, as Professor Newton has indicated in his comments on upland bird ecology, can be very positive. So it's important that Muirburn is conducted in a way that is compliant with the code, which meets the regulations imposed, and which can be properly reported. Another issue that we were very concerned about was, and it goes back to this lack of evidence as how moorlands are being managed, in the code it would be necessary to report where the Muirburn was taking place, in addition to all the other permissions that needed to be gathered in advance. So I think a statutory code for Muirburn is a major positive step forward. Perhaps Professor Newton might speak more about the impact of Muirburn more widely.
Yes, I think it's important to realise that for driven grouse management, Muirburn is central to the whole thing. If you couldn't burn heather moor, you would not get the densities of grouse that you do under burning. The idea of burning on grouse moors is to burn it in small patches, as you probably know, because the idea is that each pair of grouse in its territory, its nesting territory, has some patches of short heather, rapidly growing heather on which it can feed, and long heather in which it can take shelter from predators and so on, or in which it can nest. So that's the reason for the small patches of patchy burning that you see on grouse moors. And generally it's burnt there every on a rotation of every 10 to 15 years, so it's not that frequent. But that creates a structure on grouse moors of patches of ground of different heights of vegetation, and it's that is really important in increasing biodiversity, because you get some animals that occur in the very low patches of low vegetation and others that only live in the high vegetation and so on, whereas if you were to burn the whole lot in one go, it would be absolutely uniform. So the impact of burning on grouse moors is environmental impact is lower than it would be, you know, if you were burning it in much bigger patches. And the other advantage of that patchy growing in patchy burning or strip burning is that it provides a fire break against further, so if there is an accidental fire, it doesn't spread quite as rapidly as it would otherwise. And of course the other advantage of fairly frequent burning, as I'm sure you've discussed already, it prevents the build-up of a lot of dry trash that would create a really hot fire that gets out of control. It's very interesting to look at all the well-known cases in recent years where fires have got out of hand and burnt many square kilometres just in one go. All of them are in summer. They're outside the proper burning season, so they're not resulting from controlled burns. And they've all the big ones have been on areas that have not been burned for several decades, so there's a huge build-up of dry trash on the ground to get the fire going. And it's under those circumstances that we mostly have the cases of the fire penetrating deep into the peat, and that's where the problems start. But most of the controlled burning that's done more frequently every 10 years or so, the ideal is to get the fire going, spreading rapidly through. It's called a cool burn. It doesn't last very long, just sweeps over the ground without penetrating the peat below it, which releases most of the carbon.
So how could we out with grouse moors? So obviously that has a benefit and it stops wildfires and the devastation we've seen quite recently because of wildfires. How do we get that kind of land management, or at least management to stop wildfires and the damages that causes? How do we replicate that elsewhere out with grouse moors?
Well, the rest of the burning, I would imagine, is carried out on land for agriculture, sheep grazing land in the upland and so on. And make sure that if you are going to burn, that there are always fire breaks on hand if anything goes out of control, and don't burn it every year. I can remember in the 1950s and 60s, a lot of sheep farmers were burning every year. But that's too frequent, but you need to control it in some way or other by having fire breaks, by preventing the build-up of trash and so on over a number of years.
So as well as licensing, we should maybe be saying to landowners that they need to control the risk of wildfire on their land as well.
Yes, I think they're all, at least the ones we spoke to, they're all very conscious of the risk of wildfires. And the management of fires in general, at least on grouse moors, I think has improved enormously during my lifetime. A lot of growers now, land managers now, when they're having a fire, they take water up onto the hill, you know, tow it up in a trailer, so they've got water on hand to control it, and they have enough men on the job roundabout to keep it under control. A lot of the control fires that got out of hand were often due to insufficient manpower or wrong weather conditions and so on. But I think the code of conduct has helped a lot here. And my impression on our meetings with landowners is that they were much more conscious of Muirburn than they used to be, and doing it correctly for their own benefit, apart from anything else.
A brief supplementary, Alistair Allen.
Some of the evidence that we've taken has concentrated, or some of the things we've looked at, has concentrated on the distinction, or the proposed distinction, between peatland and non-peatland and 40 centimetres peat and all the rest of it, and some of these questions. But I'm just trying to get a picture from what you've just said there as to whether Muirburn per se is responsible, or if there is evidence that it is responsible for the kind of fires that you're alluding to there, where peat burns on the hill. But, or is this an entirely different type of fire? Is Muirburn a factor here in the type of fire where peat burns on the hill?
Well, it's bound to be a factor in that occasionally you must get a fire control burn that gets out of hand to some extent. And some of those in the past may well have led to local peat fires. But they've not in general had the sort of impact that the wildfires have had in recent years, simply because of the amount of stuff there is to burn and the length of time the fire rages over an area. But inevitably, if you're burning something, something's going to get out of control sooner or later. But you've got to make sure that you have the equipment and the manpower on the ground to stamp it out as soon as possible. We learnt during our interviews for the committee that landowners did occasionally have control fires get out of hand, but they generally brought them under control themselves without the need to call the fire brigade, because they were prepared for it. And I think that's improved in recent years.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask your views on the proposed licensing system for Muirburn.
Do you feel that it meets the needs of the recommendations that were in the review?
Do you want to do that, Alan?
Broadly, I think it does. As we've repeatedly said in the review, we didn't drill down into the level of detail, which we're now scrutinising at this legislative phase. I think our strongest recommendation was the existing code was, because it was voluntary, was not proven to be effective. The code itself, the existing code, is by and large very well constructed, but because it is purely voluntary, we felt that there were loopholes, there were occasions when non-adherence was producing the problems we've just been speaking about. So I think, as far as I'm aware, we don't have details of what that code might look like yet. That will presumably emerge at a later stage in the legislative process. But if it follows the existing voluntary code, suitably tweaked and adjusted, okay. I would regard it as meeting our recommendations. I don't know whether Professor Reid has any thoughts on this one.
Just the same challenges arise in relation to designing any licensing system. How much flexibility are you going to have? How much are you going to have rigid requirements and conditions? So exactly the same sort of debate.
Thank you.
It would appear that most of the peak damage is done when fire gets out of control. So wildfires, whatever, so it seems quite strange to impose regulations based on peat depth on that. And following on from that, your report, Professor Werity, suggested that there needed to be an increase in regulatory control relating to the Muirburn Code. Do you think the provisions in the bill if adequately address that?
I'm satisfied in the regulations as currently written in the bill as delivering on what we were recommending.
OK, thank you. Very briefly, Rachel Hamilton.
Professor Newton, you described the habitat benefits of Muirburn. On the question that Alistair Allen asked you and the convener with regard to the peat depth and the cool burning aspect, do you think there should be a single licensing scheme rather than two for under 40 and over 40?
I don't know. I'd be very happy, I think, for one licensing scheme to cover the lot. But this magical figure of 40 or 30 or 50 or whatever it may be, that's a difficult question to answer because we don't know how much, you know, if you were to lower it by 10 centimetres or raise it by 10 centimetres, we've no idea of what acreage of land would be affected by that. Mm. You know, the more you lower it, the more land is taken into that. If you're going to ban burn it, for example, if you were dropping it by 10 centimetres or 20 centimetres, how much acreage would that include in which you're going to burn it? So it's very those figures, to my mind, definite figures of 40, 30, or whatever, I can see the value of them, but it doesn't really tell you all you need to know, which is who's going to be affected and over what sort of area.
OK. Professor Reid, would like to come in.
Let me just say this is an example of the difficulty of you could just say one licence for Muirburn, wherever it is, and assume that the licensing body is then going to reflect differences in peat and so on in the licence. But that gets you back to it's very flexible, it's very uncertain. Here you've got an attempt to provide greater certainty, greater knowledge by having a specific requirement in the bill. But we're seeing the problems that gives rise to. Is it appropriate to have it at all? What should the measure be? And so on. So we come back to the same issue that there's two sides of the coin, the precision, the certainty, has its
data.
Advantages. On the other hand, the flexibility of discretion has advantages.
Yeah, and the scientific data.
And the opportunities for the scientific data to change, which is why on this measure it's specifically provided that figure can be changed to reflect the fact that the science on this is developing.
Thank you. That's a short supplement from M. Harper and then Jim Fairley.
Just a short sup about training and education. It's not, you know, Professor, you described how complex it is, like small patches and, you know, and managing a fire, make sure it doesn't get out of control. So should licences be issued in correlation with a requirement to provide education and training for, you know, our gamekeepers and land managers?
We did make that recommendation in our report. if you're going to have a code which is strongly adhered to, then all the personnel involved need to be up to speed in terms of best practice. So I think training and updating that training from time to time is also quite important. Mm-hmm. So I think we would see training of the key personnel as a fundamental part of the proposed code. Mm-hmm. I very much hope it will be included.
Okay, thanks.
It's training for all aspects, not just Millburn, but trap operation and employment of medicated grit. Everything really needs a good background of training.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Jim Fayler and Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Convener. Professor Reid, I'm going to come back to you a wee second of what you just said in terms of the licensing, you know, 30, 40, 50, whatever it is. There's currently weaknesses in the Muirburn Code in that few provisions of the Code incur penalties, and there's no robust system of monitoring and compliance. And given the fact that we're now actually going to put something in place, do you think the bill provides solutions to the issue of actually getting compliance, and are there robust enough penalties to ensure that?
You're going to need a licence. Mm. Serious non-compliance with the code is going to be a ground for revoking, modifying, suspending the licence. As we discussed with the grouse shooting licences, there could be a scope for financial penalties as an alternative remedy for that. The whole point of, because you now have the requirement for a licence, the code moves from being something that's voluntary, which if you ignore, there are absolutely no sanctions from something where if you ignore it, your licence is at risk. The third step would be to say that every provision of the code by itself is, you know, if you breach it, it itself becomes a criminal offence. Right. And I think that has huge problems because it's over-criminalising things. It would mean that the code would have to be written in a way that you could judge black and white whether an offence has been committed. So I think the current position is an appropriate one, subject to the possibility of reflecting, would there be scope for fixed penalties for example, you don't give adequate notice to your neighbours. Perhaps a fixed penalty notice for that might be appropriate rather than ministers or Nature Scott face, well, either we don't grant a licence next year or we revoke it, and so on. For minor breaches, having those more minor sanctions might be appropriate.
Yeah, would it not also require Nature Scott to be able to go out and actually measure the depth of peat?
For the peatland issues, the measuring is a problem, yes.
No. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'd be interested to hear if you feel that the recommendations on Muirburn have been addressed in the bill, and if there's anything else you'd like to see on the face. For example, in your review, you recommended increased training, which you've already addressed with my colleague Emma Harper, but also you recommended that a fire danger rating system for Scotland should be introduced to better support decision-making about where and when to burn. And you also pointed the Scottish Government to explore changes to the current RPID support payment. So I just wonder, they may not be appropriate to put on the face of a bill, but how do we make sure that those recommendations get pulled through, but also if there's anything else you think should be being addressed in the bill?
I'd say very much these are not appropriate for a bill. They're policy matters that should be pursued with the government through the stakeholders and this committee and others.
Is there anything else that you think needs to be in the bill, or are you content with the way it is now, specifically on Muirburn?
On Muirburn, I think it's obviously until you see exactly what the code is going to cover and what it's going to say, it's a bit hard to say. But it's creating a structure, a framework, which I think is adequate. It meets the requirements.
Thanks for that. I mean, so I picked up earlier when we were talking about the wildfire aspect that what we're going on is we need to go on the precautionary principle, and there's the desire to move from a voluntary practice to a regulated practice, a licensed practice, is because we are going to be seeing potentially more wildfires happening. Maybe that's of natural causes, but what I understand from talking to people who are work in this area is that actually it's always at the hand of a human, whether it's error or intentional. And I think I picked up from what you're saying there is that as we see an increase in wildfires, we're going to have an increase in workforce, equipment on hand to attend to those. And so regulating muir burn is a way of actually moving into that more precautionary space so that we're limiting the amount of what might happen from in other areas. And so that we're not... Because I think already what we've seen with the fires in Cannock and Corrymore is that the deployment of people to actually go and attend to these fires is quite challenging.
I would concur with what you've just said. That's the right direction of travel.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just before we move on, the last couple of questions. Can I have your views on what the presumption is against muir burn and that it should be the last management tool, given what you've said about control of wildfire and improving species habitats? And also, do we need more accurate data on peat depths, so more accurate to 50 centimetres rather than 40, before we bring in any regulations to give land managers a little bit more certainty?
The problem with peat depths is that I understand the existing map is based upon 50 centimetres, and if you migrate away from that, then clearly you have a challenge in how you determine that, although I think in some of the commentary on the bill there are ways of dealing with this using probes over, say, 100 metre by 100 metre square. It would be good to have perhaps the James Sutton Institute give us more detailed information on Scotland's peat soils, particularly seeing that they are so vulnerable. But that would be a major undertaking to effectively remap Scotland's peat soils. And in the interim, I think we're going to have to rely on the measures in the bill. And I very much hope that Nature Scot and Grassmoor managers will be able to find a way of determining peat debt, which is not, again, unduly onerous in the demands it makes on the estate managers, but satisfies the requirements in the bill.
OK, and just on the point of the presumption against muir burn.
I think that the provision that no other method of vegetation control is available is setting a very high standard, possibly reasonably available or something like that might be more appropriate. I think that, again, you've got the problem if you're setting a rigid test that takes away your flexibility, your ability to respond to different circumstances, and people will differ on whether or not other control is available in rocky ground, on steep ground, and so on. There can be issues, so a bit of fuzziness can actually be helpful for operating the system.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Just coming back to the peat depth piece, my understanding on why we talk about peat depth is actually a historic measurement based on the UK government at the time trying to identify energy sources. So it's actually a measurement that's about something different than what we're looking at in terms of damage to, on the one hand, we've got this peatland restoration initiative in Scotland where we're funding land managers to restore peat. And it seems to me that we're kind of talking about two different things when we start to talk about depth, when peat is actually a continuous cover. And no matter what depth, we need to be protecting that in terms of our carbon emissions. I just wondered what your thoughts are on that.
The soil map would have been produced many years ago. And wouldn't have had in mind what we've just been talking about. Certainly in terms of peatland restoration, that's a whole different area, not really within the remit of this inquiry or our report.
It just seems odd that on one hand we're trying to protect peat because we recognise that it's a super carbon sink, and on the other hand I think it's great that we're moving potentially to the licensing of it, but it just seems odd that we're funding, on one hand, protection of it, and on the other hand, we're saying it's okay to burn
no matter the depth. The restoration programme is really taking degraded peatlands and restoring them to as near as can be back to their original pristine condition. So that very often involves raising the water table, removing trees. It's a totally different agenda to what we've been talking about in terms of grouse moors. So although you can see certain parallelisms between the two areas, they are really quite discrete and separate in terms of the underlying science.
I would say that we're needing to move to an ecosystems approach and look at everything as a whole. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Very finally, Are there further recommendations that were in the Weriteri review on areas such as satellite tagging, further sentences and consolidation of wildlife law? Can you tell us to what extent do you believe that those have been implemented within the bill that's before us? And are there, do you have any recommendations of whether those recommendations should be in the bill itself or form part of a non-legislative approach? Because all your recommendations haven't been adopted. How would you like to see that addressed?
Perhaps I could ask Professor Newton to speak about satellite tagging, because I think there has been some development.
Well, satellite tagging has turned out to be one of the main methods we have of monitoring how birds of prey die. And it's revealed, as you know, a lot of interesting results, that the bulk of the mortality in several species occurs on or near grouse moors. So that's been a major source of evidence. And it may be necessary to continue that tagging into the future just to keep monitoring how the situation is going. It really has been extremely revealing, both for the golden eagles that really started this whole process, and also for hen harriers and others that have been tagged. One thing we haven't touched on so far, Convener, if I can just mention, is what the evidence is that birds of prey do suffer in the way they do on grouse moors. The evidence is a lot more substantial than one might believe. It's not just finding a few carcasses on a grouse moor. That's a trivial aspect of it. But the populations that live there are monitored annually, again, by so-called citizen scientists. And the evidence that things are going wrong on grouse moors is multiple strands to that. For one thing, a lot of the known territories each year are much less frequently occupied than they are on grouse moor, on areas outside grouse moor. Birds disappear during the breeding season. Pairs disappear much more frequently on grouse moors than they do outside grouse moors. The nesting success of the birds there is really very low compared to elsewhere. And also, quite a lot of the breeding population of some species consists of young individuals that wouldn't normally get the chance to breed in a bird population, but they can because the adult population's been reduced, so territories become available to them. So the proportion of youngsters in the breeding population. There's lots of evidence collected for individual species, and these are highly significant differences between grouse moor and other terrain. And secondly, if you do have a change in the management of grouse moor, you immediately get a response in the case of the raptors. Either they go down because a different manager comes in, or they go up. So the actual management, the way the moor is managed and their attitude to birds of prey, is immediately reflected in what happens to local raptor populations. So that's just one other line of evidence we have.
Professor Reid.
On consolidation of the legislation, this bill is clearly a backward step, because we're talking about introducing a Section 16AB into the 1981 Wildlife and Countryside Act. I'm delighted to see that the Scottish Law Commission's new programme of work includes consolidation of wildlife legislation as one of its medium-term plans, and anything this committee and others can do to make sure that actually happens and the government supports it, I would be absolutely delighted at.
Thank you. Professor Weriteri.
I have no further comments.
Okay. Can I thank the witnesses for attending this morning? That's been a hugely useful session. I'll now suspend the meeting for 15 minutes to allow for a changeover in witnesses. We'll reconvene at 10:55. I now welcome everyone back to our meeting, and we have our second panel of witnesses. Joining us this morning, we have Libby Anderson, who is a member of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, Ian Andrew, the Chief Executive Officer from the British Pest Control Association, Ross Ewing, who is the Director of Moorland and from the Scottish Land and Estates. We have Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn from the Scottish Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. We have Liz McLaughlin, the Wildlife Management Team from Nature Scot, and Alec Hogg, the Chairman of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association. And again, this morning we have approximately 90 minutes scheduled for this session. So I'll kick off with the first question. Do you agree that the provisions within the bill on the ban on the use and purchase of glue traps, which follows the advice of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, do you agree with it, and that a ban on the use of glue traps is more appropriate than a licensing system? And we'll kick off with Alec Hogg.
Sorry, I've got no comment on that one, because okay. it does not come under a remit.
That's fine.
More.
Yeah, probably might be appropriate with if we brought in Ian. Thank you.
Thank you. Our position is very clear. A public ban on the purchase and use of rodent glue traps is absolutely the right thing to do. However, as professional pest controllers, it would cause quite devastating results if we lose these tools. They're the only tool we have to capture rodents quickly. Absolutely, we have alternatives. We've got biocidal products, although the lifespan of those are in question, and we've got brake bat traps. But alongside that, we've got increasing resistance to biocidal products, genetic resistance, and increasing behavioural resistance to both brake bat traps and biocidal products. Rats and mice are clever creatures. They understand that these things are not good for them. So if we lose the only tool we've got to capture a rodent quickly, then it is going to have the results that we'll see increased populations, which in itself isn't good for animal welfare. We're also going to see businesses and organisations from supermarkets, restaurants, pubs, hospitals, schools, where there are infestations, being closed for a longer period of time. At the moment, an environmental health officer that goes in when there is an environment, when there is a rodent infestation, they want to see three clear instances of no capture on glue boards. So the premises can reopen quite quickly. Biocidal products, approximately 2 weeks. It's 2 weeks of businesses being closed before they can be reopened. Brake bat traps, again, it can take many days before rodents will go anywhere near them. From an animal welfare perspective, actually, the glue trap is just a method of capture. So if the rodent isn't on the glue board for any considerable length of time and is then humanely dispatched, their actual position on, from an animal welfare perspective, compared to biocidal death and compared to brake bat trap death, is actually more favourable. But of course, the issue with glue traps has been misuse. Some of the things that Mike's team have found is where glue traps have been put outside of buildings. I can't think of any conceivable excuse for a glue trap being deployed outside a building. Internal use, high-level infestation in high-risk areas, the only way of capturing it. And in response to the financial memorandum alongside the bill, we made a very conservative estimate that if you ban them, the closure of businesses will have an impact of about £22 million on the Scottish economy every year. And that was half of all the restaurants, shops, supermarkets being closed once every 30 years. I think that was very conservative and closed for a week. £22 million of commercial impact on the Scottish economy. So absolutely, animal welfare is critical, but it's got to be balanced with public health. Got to be.
Thank you. Any other comments? Libby.
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, I'm a member of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, which provided the report on which the Scottish Government formed the view that it would go for the full ban. And to explain the history of the report, we took evidence from many stakeholders, including Ian's organisation, the pest control industry, animal welfare advocates, environmental health and enforcement organisations. And we considered it all very seriously. And the first thing to say is that nobody disputed, and I'm grateful to Ian for agreeing here, that glue traps cause severe and generally prolonged animal suffering. And the wide view is that this is at a level that is so unacceptable that an outright ban is now justified. And I could go into some of the detail of the injuries, but you may not need that. So to look at the reasoning in the report, we took into account the public health risks and we took into account the severe animal welfare consequences. And we looked at other models, for example, New Zealand, where a very strict licensing scheme, actually an individual ministerial approval for use of any glue trap, has been brought in since 2015. And in the last year or two, the number of approvals has actually dwindled down to zero. Now, we do accept that there is a different demographic and different pattern of living in New Zealand, so we're not necessarily comparing like with like, but we can see that with the approvals literally at zero, we can see that it is effective in many situations. The other thing that we did in our report, while saying that the animal welfare issues merited a full ban and that public opinion, I think, would back that, we did set out a potential fail-safe licensing scheme, which again would be very, very specific, very case-by-case basis, and for a limited period. And we offered that as a potential alternative that might see us through the period while further developments arise in technology and the science. And I know that the industry work with scientists and they are keen to develop it. I know that they acknowledge the suffering. The point that Ian has just made there about the trap itself being relatively quick, but of course the industry code requires inspection of the traps twice daily. So that would be 12 hours potentially after being trapped in this very horrible, painful situation. And to require almost immediate inspection would be so onerous on the industry, I think that would be difficult. So it is a balance. The Commission's view was that an outright ban is justified, and we're pleased that that's the approach the bill takes.
Okay, Jim Fairley.
Yeah, a couple of curiosity, Ian. What is a glue trap and how does it work? It sounds ridiculously simple, but what is it and how does it work?
It's a piece of board covered in glue, and so typically you would form a barrier in, say it was a supermarket and there was a rat running around, you would identify where the point of ingress was, you would form a barrier so that the rodent had to cross that glue trap, they fix to the glue trap. And absolutely, the worst case would be 12 hours. But certainly from a BPCA perspective, we're quite happy that our members stay on site so that it's nowhere near 12 hours. But it just catches them, and then they are humanely dispatched, usually by blunt force trauma.
How have other countries, if, as Libby says, New Zealand has dwindled it down to zero, how have they managed to go from using them to not using them?
It's comparing apples with pears. We've got near pandemic levels of rodent infestations, particularly Edinburgh, Glasgow city centre. The populations are different. They have no genetic resistance to biocidal products in New Zealand. They've got little, and there's no research, but it would appear there's little evidence of behavioural resistance to traps in New Zealand. And they, it's just a difference now. They don't have the big cities that we have. So population levels of rodents are much less significant in that country. In other countries, they've got other methods. For example, in Europe, the drowning traps, very effective and very popular, but it's illegal in this country.
Rachel Hamilton.
Mr. Andrew, what are our populations of rodents compared to other countries, if you could compare a like-for-like country, if you have that figure?
Sorry, no, there's very little data. I mean, there's been a lot of press speculation on increased population, but I think it's probably been more a change of behaviour of rodents during lockdown, for example, where takeaways and restaurants were closed, and so they were foraging in other more domestic environments, urban environments. So, but actual numbers, you say.
So, another measure, perhaps, that you have looked at could be, or methodology of working this out could be, the number of operators who have been called out on an increasing basis to various institutions, such as maybe a hospital or a supermarket or whatever. I mean, I don't want to cause alarm with the public, but you are indicating that we have got increasing problems with rodents. So it would be good to get some understanding behind how you've come to that conclusion.
Yeah, our members are busier than ever and are getting increasingly busy. Now, it's not just rodents they're dealing with, obviously, and there's a high level of seasonality, but they are getting busier and busier, and therefore they have got increased pests to deal with. And be absolutely clear, if glue boards are banned, my members will do much better commercially, because it's going to take so much longer to get a rodent infestation under control. So for my members, if they're banned, their businesses will boom. But there's little by way of data on specific data on volume. It is mainly anecdotal. There was some research recently that included Scottish local government call-outs that would indicate that there was a slight increase. But of course, most local authorities are only dealing with local authority housing stock. They're not dealing with takeaways, hospitals, supermarkets, etc. So sadly, there's no tangible data.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. What's your kind of understanding of the current extent of use of glue traps across hospitality and, you know, settings like hospitals?
Yeah, I mean, it's thankfully fairly rare. But it is all down to, if there is an infestation, then in a high-risk area, particularly a food environment, for example, then the food safety legislation has got to be adhered to. There is a risk to public health, and therefore the rodents need to be dealt with swiftly. But my technical manager, who was a pest controller for 15 years, used them twice in her career. So, but again, there'll be geographical differences. Mm-hmm. There'll be on the Byers Road in Glasgow, I suspect they're used daily, for example, because there is that endemic problem that, despite the Prevention of Damage by Pests Act, which gives the local authorities to take a much more global approach to pest control, the rats and mice are just moving from one premises to another, from one building to another. There's no real block approach to rodent control, and each takeaway will have their own pest control company or doing it themselves. So actually, better use of the Prevention of Damage by Pests Act would actually make control so much more effective.
I was just going to say, are you saying that there would be public health implications if glue traps are not used?
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
I'm not sure. Are you including REHIS, the Royal Environmental Health Institute for Scotland, in your research committee?
I'm not aware. Right. It's certainly they're not taking part in any of the witness sessions. Right. So I'm not aware of that. Alistair Allen.
I just wonder on that theme, you know, whether, I don't know, Olivia, if this is another question for you, whether in coming to a view about banning glue traps, it was envisaged or it was discussed or debated what that transition would be to, given what Ian's been saying. I mean, what is the transition to in schools and hospitals?
Well, we have to hope that the industry will continue to work to develop improved traps. Now, there are electric traps, for example, which are not very well distributed around the country, but there are new traps coming along all the time. And when we come to talk about spring traps later, we may sort of consider those as well, but that is being developed all the time. But I hear what Ian says, that rodents don't readily go into new traps. We're looking at... The conventional solutions are things like improved proofing and prevention, and there's no doubt that many pest controllers will come along and do that or advise you to do that first of all, and in an industrial or a health premises, that would have to be ongoing constantly. The rodenticides, we know anticoagulants are pretty cruel as well, so it's not something you would just say, well, just use those and that's fine. As a result, you don't generally see the animals that have died as a consequence, but if you do, it's not very attractive. And so the Commission was very aware of potential unintended consequences, and this is why we did think give it time. But the overwhelming weight of evidence about the suffering that is caused by glue traps led us to believe that they had to go, and certainly everyone agrees that they should not be used by the public.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps it's not your remit to say, you know, what the alternative is, but it is kind of like the big question that we're all over here. What is the alternative for a hospital?
There is no one solution, and it wouldn't be correct to say that we can recommend an alternative, but we can see, for example, in the notes accompanying the bill, there's a note that says that 11 out of the 14 local authorities that responded to the bill said they did not use glue traps. There are many organisations that do not use them. Ian has mentioned they're very little used in the industry, and I'm pleased to hear that. So it seems to me it is feasible, given the overwhelming evidence about animal welfare and the goodwill and the sort of productive thinking, that a couple more years should bring better solutions. I can't tell you what it will be, but there are men of science out there, and we hope that that will be the case. I think that's a reasonable assumption.
Thank you.
Ian?
It is, but hope isn't a strategy.
Yeah.
So we hope that we'll have alternatives, but just to be absolutely clear, at the moment we don't. The glue trap is the only means of rapid capture and, when used professionally, rapid dispatch through blunt force trauma. It's the only thing we have. Everything else takes time. Biocidal products take time. Breakback traps take time. And that means hospital wards will be closed for much longer periods. School canteens will be closed for much longer periods. The already fragile hospitality sector will probably be the first to suffer, because environmental health officers have got no choice. They have to close those premises until they're free of infestation.
Okay. I've got a supplement from Jim.
Yeah. Just to clarify here, you set up a barrier of a glue trap, rat comes over the top of it. You're saying that the use of a breakback trap will take much longer. But you more or less know the behaviour of a rat. I get that there will be some resistance to it, but is there not some method that you can use with a breakback trap which will catch the rat? Because what I'm trying to think of is the behaviour of the rat. So if it's coming out, why is it coming out in the first place? If it's going to come out, it's coming out for a particular reason. It's not because you're driving it out. So therefore, if you're saying it will be done quickly, somebody's going to be on site in order to alleviate the problems that Libby's talked about. If you're using breakback traps, would you not just use more of them and make sure they're baited appropriately?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, a breakback trap's that more or less that size. A glue board is more or less that size. Mm. So you'd be putting down literally thousands of breakback traps.
How many rats are you trying to catch with this? But if you're putting down thousands of them. Sorry, I'm not trying to be facetious. I'm trying to get a picture in my head of what this looks like.
If there was a point of ingress behind the convener, for example, and that was identified as the point of ingress, nothing to do with the convener being there.
This did actually once happen in committee
many years ago.
Okay. Then effectively the barrier, so about a dozen glue boards would be placed around the convener, so that the rodent had to cross it to get to any food source or harbourage or water, because that's why they're coming in. It's, mm-hmm. it's food, water or harbourage.
What's the difference between having glue traps and breakback traps in the same numbers?
Well, the problem is that a breakback trap is literally that size. You would have thousands of them needing deployed. Mm. The practicality is such that It's just impractical.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I've got a supplement from Ariane Burgess and then Karen Adam.
Thanks, Convener. I wasn't quite sure where to bring this in, but I just want to kind of clarify. We're talking in detail, and it's really very helpful, Ian. Thank you very much about how they're used and where we'd be using them. And I get the sense that this is kind of, we need to do that 360-degree look if we're bringing in this legislation. But primarily this legislation is being reduced to address raptor persecution. And so in the policy notes, objective number 13, it says that the use of glue to trap birds in an offence, I think that's what we're trying to tackle here, isn't it?
No, we're not covering that in the section specifically. Glue traps situation.
Yes, well, I understand that, but why? So I became confused as to why we're talking at length about glue traps, and I'm just trying to get clarity here that we're talking about them because this legislation is bringing in legislation on a glue trap, but this legislation is about wildlife management and muir burn and specifically around the raptor control.
These provisions don't relate to wildlife control, specifically about glue traps. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask, there is proposals for a transition period, and I'm just wondering what your views are on that, either Libby and Ian.
Well, the Commission recommended that the proposed very strict licensing scheme should last for no more than 3 years, and we made that recommendation 2 years ago. So it's fairly simple. We would like the transition to be as short as possible.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we fundamentally don't want a transition period. We want to keep glue boards as the only tool we have for rapid capture. But licensing scheme, I mean, we're already, our members are already licensed by Liz's team for bird work, for gull work in particular. Carefully and closely and robustly licensed to do other aspects of pest control. Similarly, our members can't purchase rodenticides without proof of qualification and shortly proof of CP, continued professional development. Same applies for insecticides. So there are control measures and licensing schemes already in place that work very effectively. The gull licensing, the bird licensing online now, Liz, and very effective. Mm-hmm. And the same applies south of the border as well. So we don't want a transition. We believe we can have a very effective licensing scheme for professional pest controllers that limits their use, absolutely, to high-risk situations. And at south of the border, they're looking at the training, the qualification, the CPD of anyone that's licensed to use glue boards, which is absolutely right. But we need to keep the access to these tools. We don't want transition won't work.
Can I bring in Flynn.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. Yeah, just to pick up on a couple of points there. Just on the last point that Mr Andrew raised, not every pest controller is a member of your organisation, so they're not going to go and got that governing body. Nobody needs a licence to use a glue trap, and I'm really pleased to hear Mr Andrew saying they should totally be banned 100% for general public use. I must admit it's the general public that has caused concerns for ourselves, and a lot of that is that not everybody has got the kind of confidence and wherewithal on how to destroy an animal once it's been caught on it. So we have had them being put live on the glue trap in bins, we've had them getting drowned, horrendous things to use. They're totally indiscriminate if they're used. Now, it's been illegal since the late 50s to use any kind of glue to trap a bird. So, I mean, there's already a precedent for that. These things will catch anything. We've had homemade ones made, not the traditional. I mean, for the traditional ones, you used to be able to buy them for 99 pence at B&M's, and anybody could use them, put them in their loft and then forget about it. But we've had handmade ones that have caught up to a fox. We've had gulls caught in them. Where they've been totally misused, and that's got nothing to do with a reputable pest controller, but it's just an easy way, and they do cause suffering. And okay, 12 hours is better than just being left there, but that's still a long time for a sentient mammal to be trapped and doing whatever it is to try and free itself. Thank you, Convener.
Yeah, can I bring you in briefly and back to Karen?
Yeah, the 12 hours, I mean, we're more than happy if we're required to actually stay on site. You can't stay in the same room because that will stop the rodent coming onto the glue board, but you can stay on the premises for 3 or 4 hours or whatever. And on the technology point, that there is greater use of cameras, for example, whereby they can be monitored remotely, and as soon as something goes onto the trap, then the pest controller will have visibility of that. So the 12 hours is very much the extreme.
Karen.
Thank you. Just moving on to my next question. Police Scotland have advised that perhaps the possession as well as the use and purchase of glue traps should be included in the ban. Can I ask for views on that?
No. Any?
Nothing really.
Nothing to add.
No. So they're saying position as
possession.
Well as possession. Yeah. I mean, the reality is professional pest controllers get their products, whether it's biocidal products, break bat traps, glue traps, from about half a dozen suppliers in the UK. The public, that's a different story, but professional pest controllers will use about half a dozen. For rodenticides, there are point of sale checks. Okay. So you've got to show that you've done your qualification before you can purchase
right.
them. Our relationship with Amazon and eBay, for example, we get things taken off almost overnight. So if they were banned for public use and they came on to eBay, that our relationship is such that they'd be taken down immediately.
Okay. I'm looking. Well, Ariane, did you want to come in on a supplementary?
I do actually want to pursue the question I was raising earlier, because if I look at the policy memorandum in the legislation, the bill is bringing in a ban on glue traps. It says here that the bill is being introduced to address raptor persecution and ensure that the management of grouse moors and related activities are undertaken in an environmentally sustainable and welfare-conscious manner. And then in policy note 13, it talks about the use of glue to trap birds is an offence. So I just wonder, are glue traps used? I mean, is that what we're trying to do here with the glue trap ban?
No, it's quite clear that the provisions on glue traps are not related to grouse moor management. They're related to general animal welfare.
Okay, so then there's something confusing in the policy memorandum that maybe needs to be clarified with the government bill team.
Okay.
I mean, I just wonder why they mention that the use of glue traps, the glue to trap birds is an offence. So are glue traps used to trap birds?
No. Sorry, it's not my position as convener. My understanding is no. Jim, did you have a supplementary on glue traps before we move on to wildlife traps?
Mike probably answered it. Thank you.
Okay. We're now going to move on to the theme of wildlife traps, and I've got a question from Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. I'm not sure who's going to answer this, but the question is, do you agree there's a need for additional regulation of the use of wildlife traps? And what's your experience with the use of spring traps and live capture bird traps? And what evidence is there that traps are misused in relation to both animal welfare and wildlife crime concerns?
Who'd like to kick off? Ross.
Thanks, Convener. So I think what I'd refer to in terms of the rationale for this is broadly, I would say, set out in the policy memorandum. So paragraph 58 refers to the illegal use of traps on around grouse moors and qualifies that with two references to incidents where raptors were persecuted using a spring trap. It then goes on to say where live capture traps have been used to persecute raptors, they are usually either ladder traps or funnel traps. So the inference that's being made in the policy memorandum is that traps are sometimes used to persecute raptors on grouse moors. The only thing I'd draw the attentions committee to, really, in terms of the actual evidence base for this, is the official wildlife crime record. And you'll see from the latest record, which was published in this year and dates back to 2021 because of the lag, that trapping raptors, instances of birds of prey crime involving trapping, is consistently lower than it is, for example, for shooting or poisoning. So if you're looking at the actual scale of the issue, it is by far and away less than the issues associated with shooting and poisoning. And the other important thing to say, and I need to make this point really clear, is that wildlife crime record does not specify where these incidents have taken place. So we cannot say with certainty that those trapping incidents, for example, all happened exclusively in relation to grouse moors. So I think there is, I would say, a fairly weak evidence base, to be honest, for the introduction of further regulation on the use of certain wildlife traps in this context. And it's regrettable, I think, that the policy memorandum has not expanded on those in a little bit more detail. As I say, I mean, the fact that we're going to be talking about introducing a licensing scheme for numerous spring traps, the supporting evidence for which is summarised in two anecdotal references to raptor persecution, I think is largely deficient, and I think is something that probably needs to be clarified further by the Scottish Government.
Just on that, can I ask? Hugh Dignan in previous sessions referred on more than one occasion to fen traps, but it's my understanding the scent of fen traps is illegal at the moment, so those fen traps wouldn't come under any new potential licensing scheme.
So the traps that are used, by far, I couldn't speak to the exact legalities around it, but the traps that are generally used on grouse moors are dock traps, and I'll probably defer actually to Alec to speak in a little bit more detail about the sort of traps that are generally associated with grouse moor management.
Okay, guys. Well, last year before, maybe, I think it was the Russian Federation wanted to... They made it illegal for fen traps to kill stoats because they weren't killing them in 38 seconds. Well, breakback trap, which we were using, was a fen trap. So we all had to change our management, and every person who now catches a stoat, or catch other things, but the stoat was particular in this one. Every person that now catches a stoat has either got a dock or a tilly trap that we use. And these traps are heavy. Catch your fingers in them, you're going to break them. They're so strong and immediately kill the animal. They're actually very good traps. And every grouse moor has now transferred over at a cost of thousands of pounds. Or you can imagine a fen trap was about £9 or £10. These new traps are all running about £40. Huge expense, but we've done it, and it works well. It works really well. The animals don't suffer, and that's what's true.
OK. Jim Fairley.
Yep.
Are you OK? Question six, Rachel Hamilton.
Well, I suppose I'll start off with asking whether the licensing scheme is proportionate and workable, which includes a requirement for compulsory training and registration for all trap use. And a supplemental to that, whilst I'm asking this question, would be, should there be a bespoke scheme that's identified to one serial number rather than individual serial numbers, where an operator may not use all of those traps? We'll start with Alex Hogg.
I think we're doing a lot of training. We've done all the snare training, so we're really up for doing the trap training and getting it right. So whatever you can decide on in the finish, we'll comply with it and get the guys up to speed with the training.
Okay.
I think I'd add to, I mean, your question was, is it workable and proportionate? I think broadly, given the current provisions, I would say the answer is no. And that's not, I think, not, it's not through the Scottish Government's own fault, but I think there's been a lack of awareness about the potential unintended consequences of this. So let me just allow, if you may, Convener, just to set out the key problem. And it does relate to the imposition of unique licence numbers on traps that are used much more readily than, for example, traps that are used to catch live birds, which are the only traps at the moment that are currently subject to unique licence numbers. So the implication of putting unique licence numbers on all trapping infrastructure, including spring traps, essentially results in that trapping infrastructure becoming personalised. It is tied to a specific operator. Now, that shouldn't be a problem, but it is. And the reason that that's a problem is because of the extent of trap interference, tampering and sabotage in the Scottish countryside. And this committee has probably got the biggest wealth of evidence, actually, anywhere to suggest what the scale of this problem is, because in the call for views that you ran recently, a number of gamekeepers responded to that and made clear the kind of sort of incidents that they were faced with. And you'll actually see in your summary of the call for views, where you did your analysis, under the question, do you agree that there is a need for additional regulation of the use of certain wildlife traps? Those that disagreed, one of the key words that was used was sabotage. So it's clearly something that a lot of people spoke to in their responses to this committee. And the reason that's a problem is if you've got a unique licence number that is tied to a trap, that trap has then been sabotaged, i.e. it's been made illegal through other ways and means, through the actions of a third party. That trap is then tying the illegally set operation to an individual. And that individual is much more likely, if there's a unique licence number there, to be the suspect in any investigation that then comes down the line. And of course, we know that under an investigation, in the context of this licensing scheme, you can have your personal licence to trap suspended. But moreover, the licence to shoot grouse as well could be suspended by the initiation of an official investigation. So you can see, I appreciate that was a lot of steps to go through, but the unintended consequence of personalising trap infrastructure, where there is rife kind of interference, sabotage and tampering with infrastructure in the Scottish countryside, has got unintended consequences, and I think it's just important we set that out.
I think it's really serious, sorry, to say that Facebook, as soon as they've done it, they put it on Facebook and it's all over the place, before they even get back, encouraging this behaviour, and it's scary. It really is.
I actually want to explore what happens.
Can I just we've jumped a bit. Just the nature of a round table, and that's good. So if we've got some supplementaries and things like that, can we focus on the trap tampering at the moment? That's probably helpful, and we'll explore that issue. I think Karen wants to come in and Rachel.
Yeah, it was just for the purpose of clarity and for the record. Why would somebody be sabotaging and tampering with traps?
So it's a really good question. So I think some people are ideologically opposed to grouse shooting. So if they're walking on a grouse moor and there's a trap there, they might well take it into their own hands to sabotage it. Some people, similarly, are ideologically opposed to the use of traps for wildlife management. Killing a sentient being for some people is too much and they do not agree with it, and therefore they take matters into their own hands. And some people, frankly, don't know what they're doing. They come across this thing and they think it's fun to smash it up. So there's all sorts of broad motivations. I mean, I should stress that these are my kind of assumptions, but I imagine these are the sort of things that go through people's head when it actually comes to the kind of sabotaging, interference and tampering with trap infrastructure.
Okay. Rachel. I wanted to ask about what happens, what are the implications of the humane use of traps if they are interfered with? And, you know, what I know that I've spoken to gamekeepers in my own constituency who have had traps interfered with, and that is quite distressing. But to have a serial number that's related, as you're suggesting, Ross, that would indicate that they would then be at potential of prosecution.
So one of the most common things that happens in the context of people being kind of sabotaged is that the box or the tunnel over which the spring trap sits gets removed, so therefore exposing that trap to the elements. Now, clearly that carries significant animal welfare consequences, because if something, you know, that's not meant to be caught, a non-target species, get caught in that, there's clearly going to be some pretty seismic consequences for the animal welfare components, you know, that most gamekeepers obviously take into account when they're setting these things. So the act of exposing the trap to the elements is probably one of the things that you see most often, and that's certainly reflected in the responses to the call for views. And you're absolutely right. I mean, I think the big problem here is that if that sort of incident happens, if someone removes the tunnel or the box, it's exposed to the elements, and someone comes across it and reports it, then obviously a unique ID number immediately links it back to that individual, and they then are the subject, most likely, of an investigation, which, as we've heard, could come with the consequences of a licence being suspended.
So despite the... You know, we had the feedback from the call for views, but to what extent is it an issue? Because we heard in the earlier panel that there's very few, if any, prosecutions on tampering with traps.
Yep.
So can you tell us what the extent of it is, in your opinion, but also what stakeholders would suggest as the route to stop tampering?
So the first point on the extent of it, I mean, just to give you a flavour, so we put on surgeries to help people respond to the consultations associated with this bill, given the gravity of the consequences. Of over 100 gamekeepers that I interviewed, I can count on one hand the amount of people that were not impacted by some way through trap interference, tampering or sabotage. So that gives you a feel of the scale of the problem. Obviously, you've got the individual responses there. I'd also refer you to the public consultation that preceded this bill as well. And in the analysis of that, it said the potential for malicious tampering with or damage to traps was a key concern of some of those who felt that the proposed penalties are too severe, and also that some of those who disagreed at question 29, which was the relevant question, suggested that if proposals are taken forward, there should be an equivalent offence of interfering with legally set traps. And that is fundamental, because ultimately the act of interfering could result in the trap itself becoming illegally set. That carries animal welfare implications, and the strongest feeling from the sector is that the penalties for trap interference, tampering or sabotage should equal those of missetting a trap in the first place. I mean, that seems logical to me, but obviously leave it to your view, committee.
Okay, sticking specifically with tampering before we move on, Alec.
You can imagine a lot of the traps are baited by rabbit
tampering,
and as long as they're covered, they work perfectly well. But if they're tampered with and the cover's lifted off, this rabbit is then exposed to eagles or buzzards or whatever that come over, and next thing you've got a huge incident. Well, a rat that in a trap, and it's just so bad and serious.
Okay.
There's a piece on training that hasn't been covered within the question.
We're absolutely going back.
Okay.
So we're just sticking to tampering at the moment, and we'll bring in other. We're going to go back to the questions on regulation, whatever, in a minute. But I want to stick to this at the moment, Mike.
And just quickly, back to Ross's point regarding tampering and stuff. If your tap is registered to Mike Flynn and it's interfered with, it's still up to the prosecution to show that Mike Flynn actually said at the time. It might be in my name, but somebody's still got to prove that it was actually me that was operating at the time. And I would agree with the countryside people, there should be a specific offence for anybody that interferes with a lawfully set trap, because if it's lawfully set, any suffering should be minimised, and it's out with their control if it is tampered with. And I think at the moment it can be malicious mischief, possibly theft, possibly vandalism, but there should be a specific offence.
I've got Ariane on this same topic.
Thanks very much, Convener, and that's good to hear that point, Mike. I just wondered if we've got any developments in terms of technology. So we're aware of digital technology that supports us with the rapt persecution aspect of this. I wonder if there's some kind of digital technology that we could apply to traps so that you can see if it's being tampered with. Just as you can see a vessel's activity in our inshore, you could actually see activity on a trap and yep.
Some people, Ariane, do take it upon themselves to actually set trail cameras where they've set traps. The problem is that spring traps are used so numerously across grouse moors that doing that for every single one is probably practically impossible. But where we have seen prosecutions, successful prosecutions, it's generally resulted on either the keeper sitting out and actually watching to see what's happened and, you know, taking the evidence accordingly, or setting a piece of technology like a trail camera.
But I wonder if we could take that technology further and actually have something within the trap so that you can tell you know, whether it's been moved at a time, right? Just as you can do that remotely for many other aspects of things, surely we could move in that direction.
I'm certainly not aware of it. Something's being done at the moment, but, you know...
An opportunity, perhaps,
yeah.
OK, we're going to jump back to look for additional regulation. I think Jim Fairley had a question to ask on that.
Yep. Thanks, Convener. I'm just very conscious of the fact that that has been answered by a gamekeeper and someone who represents Scottish Land and Estates. So I wanted you to get a balanced understanding. Libby, Mike and Liz, do you feel there is a need for additional regulation in the setting of these charts? We'll start with you, Mike.
Yes, I certainly do. And I'm all for training, which Alex supports and his organisation can do. We have had people who have been on a training course for snares who then abused it. And that kind of knackers them when they go to defence for the fact that I didn't know the law. You do know the law because you were trained and you were passed in that training. So, yes, anything that could potentially kill an animal, as far as I'm concerned, should always be a last resort. But if it's got to be used, it should be by trained individuals. And if they break the law, they've got no excuse because they actually, as part of that training, are told exactly what the law is. And my last bit about the tampering rate, if all this comes in, records, strict records would have to be kept, which would say I visited my snare, my trap or whatever on that day and it had been interfered with. So that is a defence for the person as well, because I've already declared that, other than reporting it to the police.
Libby.
Yes, thank you. So the reason that live traps and spring traps are included in the bill is because Professor Werris's report identified a connection between the use of traps and raptor persecution, which gave rise to the bill. But from the Commission's point of view, we would welcome their being included and we'd see an opportunity to improve welfare issues, because both live bird traps and spring traps do pose welfare challenges. In the case of crow cage traps and larsen traps, there are known welfare issues to do with the decoy bird being confined for a lengthy period, with all of the birds being exposed to the elements, with limited, well, food and water is only provided to the decoy bird. For example, the trapped birds are meant to be there for only 24 hours, but that could be a very long period in a winter day up on the mountain. So there are inherent welfare issues, and there are also concerns about the way that birds are dispatched when the operator comes to inspect them, and we've seen evidence of birds being poorly dispatched with suffering as a consequence. So this gives...
Could you explain to me what you mean by poorly dispatched?
Yes. So quite some years ago, I remember the organisation I worked for at the time was observed a keeper going into a cage and attempting to kill the birds by just laying about him with a stick. So I'm sure colleagues from the profession would not agree that's an appropriate way to attempt to kill a dozen crows.
That brings me back on to the point that Alec talked about in terms of actual training and the professionalism of the people who are actually carrying out this act. Would that not... Mm-hmm. be part of the process?
Well, I think that's what I would like to move on to talk about, and the advantages of training, not only to ensure that best practice is observed, but really for accountability and to maintain standards. And I, as Alex said, I don't think there's any objection to training. The concerns that have been identified are more about the ID tags and problems about potential sabotage, which are beyond my ken, frankly. If I could just very quickly say something else about the welfare issues around spring traps, because while live bird traps are used under a general licence and there is accountability and there are welfare standards applicable because they're live animals, for the spring traps, the theory is that the animals will be killed instantly or rendered irreversibly unconscious instantly. Now, we know that simply isn't always the case. And the humane trapping regulations that Alec referred to earlier, they do only apply to stoats, but the same type of traps could be used for weasels, squirrels, rats, and there are no specific humane trapping regulations for them. So, at the moment, for spring traps, there's little accountability. There's no recording of the animals that are caught. There's no recording of animal welfare issues. There's no need to demonstrate the need to kill these animals. And all of that could be incorporated into a licensing scheme and could be the subject of training. So these are the advantages that we see.
Can I bring in Liz, please?
I would just say that the use, we recognise the use of spring traps and other live capture traps for birds have got an important wildlife management, they're an important wildlife management tool. But if used inappropriately, be that because they've been tampered with or they've been set inappropriately or whatever, if they're used inappropriately, in addition to the welfare issues that we've discussed, there's also the risk of capturing protected species and other non-target species if they've not been appropriately set.
Just on that, so as the expected licensing authority, how are you going to go about developing the systems and approved training courses to address some of the things that you've touched on? And, you know, what resources do you think you're going to require? Will they be available? And when do you foresee a decision around, you know, the cost of this and potentially cost recovery being made?
So, as with our other licensing approaches and schemes that we've got, we would develop the licensing scheme in conjunction with stakeholders. We would listen to the interested parties, just the same as we've recently done with mountain hares and things, and we would develop a proportionate approach. We already obviously have a registration, traps registration system that we use. We've already moved that registration process online, so it's simple, it's effective. We know who's licensed, and we would expect to extend that registration scheme to incorporate the new requirements of the bill. It would require additional resource in terms of further developing the online system. There's going to be a cost associated with that. But in terms of actually managing the system once it's up and running, the additional resource required for that would be minimal on top of the resource we already have allocated.
So is it likely we'll know exactly what the approach to fees and full cost recovery will be before we complete stage one of the bill?
Probably not, although, you know, that as we go through the process and into stage two, we'll develop a better idea of the scale and the cost.
OK, thank you. Now, we've jumped around a bit here, so I'm very conscious some members may not have got to ask the question that they would like. So is anybody any further questions on proportionality, workability, reporting and whatever in this section?
Question 8.
Jim.
Can I just go back to 6?
To where you are, yeah. We cut you off in 6.
Yeah, thanks. It's developed, actually, because I don't think it's been answered as to if a trap was registered with a unique licence number and gamekeepers or others, it could be used in an urban setting as well, that they had unique licence number but had to do the training for all of the traps that weren't necessary. I'm trying to establish whether the licensing scheme is too broad brush and should be specifically designed to accommodate or recognise the need of the operator themselves. That's one question. And my second question is around the, which Libby mentioned, which was on the agreement on international humane trapping standards. And you mentioned the trapping of stoats, which happens in Orkney. Now, we've been told that they are very high standards, and those traps are designed because of the high standard rather than the need for expertise from the operator. So how can we use that as an example to recognise a licensing scheme when it's the actual spring trap that is is designed to such high standards? I'll start with Libby.
They would definitely still require the expertise of the operator, and previous reports about not misuse of trap, but traps causing welfare issues would concern the place they were set. So they're set on a rail and the trap cage became entangled with vegetation, and that could affect the action of the trap, and therefore the animal, assuming it was the target animal, would not necessarily be killed cleanly when it went in. And there are many examples of animals being caught by the paw, by the face, by the back leg. This has been happening for many, many years, and there's no question about it.
But these have only just recently been approved.
So the agreement on international humane trapping standards goes way back to about 2009, I think. And there was a long implementation period for various parties. It finally came into force under the humane trapping regulations in 2020. It only affects stoats. So the agreement, the wider international agreement, covers all fur bearers that are trapped for fur. In the relevant countries. Now, they don't cover foxes, for example, and they don't cover mink, but they do cover stoats because ermine is a sought-after fur in some areas. Now, this was an international agreement. It was inevitably a bit of a compromise, and the standards for killing traps allow a time to irreversible unconsciousness of 45 seconds for stoats, and that's what the new traps correctly set can achieve. It's a longer period, it's 120 seconds for martens, and it's 300 seconds, 5 minutes, to irreversible unconsciousness for other species. Now, we wouldn't allow that in a slaughterhouse. You know, that is not what you would define as humane slaughter. And therefore, it's arguable that the standards themselves need to be looked at. And again, in looking at licensing conditions, we have an opportunity to say what is the best welfare that can be offered by traps.
Okay. And just on the point about the individual serial numbers on each trap that is related to the operator, does the panel have any views on whether that is proportionate?
I mean, I think it would make sense for each operator to have one unique ID number, so that there is not kind of multiple pieces of replication, you know, depending on each different type of trap they use. That strikes me as an ordinarily sensible thing to do.
Okay, just before we move on again, whether the bill's proportionate, we've talked about licensing and the penalties regarding that and the potential grave consequences of a licence being removed. Do you think it's proportionate that someone who has a trap set incorrectly or a trap that's potentially been tampered with could face a licence being suspended? Because ultimately, that can be suspended on the instigation of an official investigation rather than any proof of guilt or burden of proof.
Yeah.
Is that proportionate?
No, absolutely not. I mean, this is a provision that extends through all three licensing schemes, and obviously the extent to which European Convention of Human Rights are engaged are highest in the context of the grouse shoot licence. However, you know, the notion that a licence could be suspended, one, without the regulator being satisfied that a relevant offence has been committed, and that's what it says in statute, and two, on the basis of official investigation, you can understand why that provides certainly our members and indeed keepers on the ground with a great deal of concern, because ultimately, you know, and I'm not saying that Nature Scot would necessarily behave in this way, but in statute they would be perfectly able to take away someone's licence if they were not satisfied that a relevant offence be committed, provided an official investigation has been established. And just to give you a flavour of how easy it would be to establish an official investigation, all it would take is a phone call, you know, to a police officer to say, I saw gamekeeper X on estate Y missetting or removing the tunnel off trap Z. You know, that would be how easy it would be.
I suppose the follow-on from that is, but how do we ensure that traps are set? Do we need to look at higher penalties when it is found that a gamekeeper or a pest control agent has set the traps illegally? How do we address it? Because this is all about reducing animal suffering, whatever.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think the penalties reflected in the bill, I mean, there's obviously made the endeavour to increase the penalties that would be afforded to this, which I think is something we'd all appreciate. I mean, we don't support people missetting traps. That is, you know, right and proper. But I think the extent to which that this could potentially be interfered with via vexatious ways and means is really obvious to us and something we think needs to be addressed.
OK, Liz would like to come in on this.
I would just say that we have a huge amount of experience in terms of licensing and licensing approaches. We issue approximately 90 different types of licences to approximately 5,000 licence holders per year. And so we have a lot of experience in terms of dealing with sanctions in relation to licences. And there is a scale of sanctions. We acknowledge that there are different types of breaches to licences from administrative errors right through to unlawful activity. And that happens across our entire suite of licensing. And we operate a compliance monitoring system that has a scale of sanctions depending on the type of breach and what we're looking for in relation to the different types of sanctions. We also have a very good relationship with Police Scotland. And work with them very closely in terms of what's going on in any particular set of circumstances that are brought to our attention. So it wouldn't necessarily translate that somebody would phone us up, we would receive a phone call from somebody to make an accusation against an individual that would automatically there and then result in the suspension of a licence. We would follow up with inquiries and we would look for evidence the same as we currently do in relation to our current general licence restrictions. You know, we look at the body of evidence in relation to each incident.
If I could just commit, so I completely accept the points that you've set out there, Liz, and I do not doubt for one second your ability and the team that you manage's ability to do this, but in statute, what is written in the legislation, you would have the power to suspend someone's licence if on the basis of an official investigation being established and without you actually being satisfied a relevant offence being committed. So any right to appeal that follows for the practitioner thereafter is materially weakened by the fact that in legislation, the regulator does not need to be satisfied that a relevant offence is being committed, provided an official investigation is established. So, to us, that's a systematic failure and leaves people wide open to vexatious allegations.
The gamekeepers are very worried about this suspicion thing. Scared us to death when we've seen it.
Yeah.
Can I ask, it's certainly something that was raised at the last session about there are no requirement for Nature Scotland actually to be satisfied. It's just that an official investigation, and as far as I'm aware, as soon as someone phones the police and the police take any action, it's official. There's never any unofficial police investigation. What's your comments on that sort of cloudy area in the legislation?
Probably the best example to use that we operate at the moment in terms of our general licence restriction. We operate an agreed framework in relation before we restrict the use of general licence to any estate, and we are looking for evidence of crimes against wild birds in that instance. So myself, I work very closely with the police. And in relation to removing the use of the general licence, I'm looking for evidence again of crimes against wild birds, and that for Nature Scott is evidence of a crime being committed, i.e. the police have crimed and allocated a crime number to the incident. That's in relation to obviously a civil burden of proof of crime, but that's the type of thing that we that we operate, and what I mean by, you know, we have a scale of sanctions that we can use depending on the type of breach. If it's a, you know, what we would deem a technical breach of a licence condition, then we can offer warning letters, or initially we would write providing advice. We can write warning letters, and so the sanctions can scale up to the point of if there's a crime being committed and the police have crimed it, then we can remove licences.
So, but specifically on the bit of legislation that says the Nature Scot doesn't have to be satisfied, are you comfortable with that within the legislation?
Yep, we can work with that.
I'm sorry, but that just gives the regulator excessive discretionary power. Right, and you know, it does not provide us, our members, with adequate safeguards. It doesn't provide keepers with adequate safeguards. It basically means that, you know, there's no burden of proof at all. You talk about the civil burden of proof. This constitutes no burden of proof, because an official investigation can be triggered by a vexatious allegation very, very easily.
Okay, Jim Feely and then Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, I'm feeling a bit of deja vu. We've been here before. Yeah. We did this with hunting with dogs as well. What I'm taking out of it is that working relationship between landowners, keepers and Nature Scot is absolutely paramount.
Yeah.
So that there's a proper understanding. You all sit here and agree with it. But so I don't understand why there is such a level of concern that you're going to be prosecuted, or that a gamekeeper will be prosecuted by virtue of a vexatious allegation, when you have the working relationship with the licensing authority.
With the greatest respect, Jim, a working relationship is not a protection in law against, and it's not an adequate safeguard. So while I have absolute respect for Liz, absolute respect for other people at Nature Scot, there's nothing to say that someone couldn't come in that maybe has got a bit more of an agenda and actually exercise the full discretionary powers that are afforded to them in this legislation. Relationships change, right? And relationships are not a safeguard at all to people having licences taken away because an official investigation has been established via vexatious ways and means.
Okay.
Can I just... So it's not... Individual working relationships are important in the management of our licensing approaches. Obviously, Nature Scot has policy and procedures in place. We have frameworks that we operate to. So it should never come down to personalities and things like that. You know, I, in delivering my job, every one of my team of licensing officers delivering their job is bound by Nature Scot policy, procedure, our frameworks and how we operate. So, you know, those are the systems, if you like, that guide us in our licensing. If people are not happy with how we have undertaken a licence, where how it's been assessed, if they're not happy with the decision that we make as a public body, everybody has a right to appeal, and our licensing appeals are dealt with through you know, the same as any complaints to Nature Scot. And obviously, if we're not, if individuals are not satisfied with that, then again, as a public body, we are subject to the remit of the public body ombudsman. So, and ultimately, you know, judicial review is the way. So, you know, I would argue that there are checks and balances in the process of how Nature Scot, as a public body, can operate in terms of delivering in this instance the licensing approaches.
Can I just go back to in 12D of the legislation, modification, suspension and revocation of licences, it clearly states that relevant authority may suspend a wildlife trap licence if, despite the relevant authority not being satisfied, as mentioned in paragraph B2, if there is an official investigation or proceedings in relation to a suspected relevant offence. That takes Nature Scot out of the loop. So it's you can voice your concerns that you're not satisfied that an offence is taking place, but a licence can still be suspended. That's the question. Are you comfortable with that?
Yes. Okay. We can operate with that. As a body, we can operate in that way.
And we've got the greatest degree of respect, trust and confidence in Nature Scott, but the fact of the matter is all those processes that Liz referred to differ from the legislation. That legislation clearly gives the regulator the power to suspend a licence on the basis of an official investigation without being satisfied. To us, how does that provide any degree of safeguard to those operating wildlife traps, to those operating grouse shoot businesses, to those operating muirburn licences? Okay. It doesn't.
Thank you. Sorry, Liz.
We have a working relationship with the police. We are not an investigating authority in our own right. So, if the police come to us with a concern of an incident that has occurred, they won't. Go into, quite rightly, they don't go into all the fine details over the whys and wherefores of their investigation. If the police are investigating an incident, we will have that discussion, but I won't necessarily know all the whys and wherefores of what's going on, who's done what, who's suspected of doing what, all of those details. So I think that is the point that the legislation is making, that Nature Scott is not an investigating agency. That, at the moment, is Police Scotland. They are the ones that would do the investigation. So whether we would have the information at the start of that investigation to be totally satisfied of what has occurred is not within our remit.
Okay, I've got Rachel Hamilton and then Karen.
Liz, what you're talking about is beyond civil and criminal standard, isn't it, to be able to suspend a licence? You say that Police Scotland have the ability to then make that decision pending investigation. But this goes beyond what is currently in place.
We would have the legislation would give us the power to suspend licences. We already have the under the Wildlife and Countryside Act, the licences that we issue under the Wildlife and Countryside Act. We already have the ability to suspend licences or revoke licences that we've issued. So we already. Can do that for a variety of reasons.
Okay. Can I also ask just on Libby's point there about larson traps and a decoy bird? You said that in the upland, a decoy bird could be in a larson trap for up to 24 hours. If you're in a remote and rural area, how is that established?
Certainly what I meant to say was that the decoy bird could be there considerably longer than 24 hours. The trapped bird should only be there for 24 hours because the traps must be inspected.
But how do you know that?
How do I know?
How do you have the evidence? Does someone sit on the hill for that length of time?
Well, that's the operator would be inspecting it, inspecting the trap regularly because that's a condition of the licence.
Okay, and so what you're asking for is what gamekeepers currently are doing, which is using EpiCollect to monitor some of the activities that the operators are carrying out in terms of innovation, technology, that sort of thing. I can't work out how. I'm very confused about how you're establishing that there is evidence that the operators are carrying out bad practice without actually having the evidence?
Well, there are many, many reports from many organisations, some of whom are, you know, in the audience today.
Well, who?
From, well, RSPB, One Kind, Scottish SPCA formal reports of welfare issues taking place within crow cage traps.
Do they sit on the hills?
I don't suppose they do. I've no idea. But the reports come in and welfare issues are observed. So you might find insufficient shelter for the decoy bird. You might find it doesn't have the right size or perch.
No, I understand that. Yeah. I mean, we are here to tackle wildlife crime. So, these animal welfare issues, but I just can't understand how there is evidence to suggest that, or if it's peer-reviewed, or I'm trying to
grasp this. Well, there is peer-reviewed evidence, and the welfare issues surrounding traps have been examined by, I think it was Nature Scot and SASA, so there is, there have been reports on the issues surrounding these traps. But I think what you're asking me is whether welfare issues arise in crow cage traps and larsen traps?
Well, you said that they did.
Yes, I did say that, and there is evidence of that. And you were also asking about inspection, and that is a requirement of the general licence. So if you found that, if you could see that a trapped bird had been there for longer than 24 hours, then that would be a breach of the licence. And Liz will correct me if that's wrong.
Alex wants to come in.
I just want to say that all the keepers are trained to a really high standard now. We check a crow cage trap every 24 hours. The decoys are well looked after. They get a proper shelter, proper food, proper perches. It's so difficult now with the public, every public member seeing things like this, and we're doing it absolutely to the highest standard. So I would totally disagree with what Libby's telling you.
I think that's good news, what you're saying, but it also means that training and licensing should be less burdensome, doesn't it?
I think we don't mind the licensing as long as when people interfere with what we're trying to achieve, and that then causes serious problems.
Mm. Hey, I've got Karen.
Thank you. It was just to go back to the adequate safeguarding. Ross, you spoke about, vexatious complaints and interference and things. What would you see as adequate safeguards?
So I think there's a few things that need to be happen. I think the provision that allows for a licence to be suspended on the basis of official investigation without the regulator being satisfied needs to be removed in toto. I mean, I've got serious concerns whether that's genuinely ECHR compliant. And point number two is really trying to raise awareness and trying to deter people from vexatiously tampering and interfering and sabotaging traps. I think the way to do that is by making it a bespoke offence to tamper, interfere or sabotage a legally set trap, and making sure that those penalties reflect those that exist or that will exist for those that are missetting traps, as is defined in this bill.
I think that's really helpful, because if people are tampering with traps to, in their mind, because they don't agree with the killing of animals, but they are, in fact, killing animals by doing that, then
in
that
the most
education
grotesque way,
needs to be there.
Absolutely. Completely agree.
OK. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to direct this question to Libby and Mike Flynn. But I'd be interested to hear, we started to talk about larsen traps and crow cage traps, and I'd be interested to hear what are the animal welfare concerns related to multi-catch crow cage traps and larsen traps for trapped birds and also decoy birds. You kind of talked about that. I'd like to hear a bit more.
Yeah. Yes, I think I've covered them, so I'll try and be brief. But so as soon as you trap a live animal, obviously you're putting its welfare at a degree of risk and you're responsible for its welfare. And the general licences have actually raised welfare standards for crow cage traps and larsen traps quite considerably over the last few years. So the decoy bird receives a limited amount of welfare provision. So that's the bird that's captured to attract in the other birds into the trap. And there is a requirement to provide it with food and shelter and water, but it's still confined either in a relatively small larsen trap or in the bigger crow cage trap. And it's close to others congeners, as we call them, of their own species, where they don't want to be. So there's obviously psychological distress is likely to be caused by that. And then I also mentioned they're exposed to the elements, so they could be in considerable heat or considerable cold. And there is the risk that they won't be inspected daily. I'm glad to hear that that's is definitely the case, Alex says. But if they're not inspected every day, and in times of severe weather, the general licence suspends the requirement to go and inspect daily for understandable reasons of human welfare, but of course the birds are left out there. So there are many risks that the birds are put at inherently before you even have bad practice of inadequate provision or poor dispatch, as I mentioned earlier.
Thanks very much for that clarity.
Basically the same as Libby said, and I'm not going to disagree with Alex, but not everybody plays by the rules. And I totally recognise that every industry has got rogue people, and it sadly lets everybody down. But no, suffering canicker, I mean, we have found trapped birds in cage crow traps that have been left to starve to death. Now, whether that be something was wrong with the gamekeeper or that, I don't know. But they can suffer, and we do have concerns about the call bird in larson traps, because that isn't natural. It's in a too confined a space. I mean, if you were to keep a pet parrot like that, you'd be breaking the law, because it must be able to stretch its wings freely in all directions and stuff. Mm-hmm. So the kind of basis of larson traps is something that we personally don't agree with either.
Thank you.
I'm going to bring Alec in, and then the next question.
Just quickly, to respond to Mike's thing about the bird starving to death in a larson trap or a crow cage trap. What we do now with our training is we advise everybody, again, because of interference, we used to lock the door open. Now we advise them to take the door away completely. So there's no way that bird can ever get caught. So the training says take your door home. Quite often we used to lock it back with padlocks and things like that, but people always interfered with things. So take the door away, and then that can happen.
Okay, thanks. Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. I just want to touch on just now the understanding of the extent of the use of wildlife traps in Scotland and what their overall impact is on animal welfare and biodiversity. And what is your view on the suggestion that licensing should be supported by statutory reporting in order to increase the transparency and better understand the impacts? Alec, I want to direct that to you first, if that's okay.
Go and repeat the guess for me.
So, the numbers and the extent of use of wildlife traps in Scotland and their overall impact on biodiversity.
Mm-hmm.
And your view on the suggestion that licensing should be supported by statutory reporting. In other words, if you've set 100 traps, you've got to say where those 100 traps are, what you've actually caught in them, how many animals are killed on an annual basis.
We would agree with that. Again, it's with training. We do it with snaring at the moment, so it could easily be done with the traps. And it would be feedback to the government and Nature Scotland, maybe what animals are being trapped and dispatched, whatever, on your ground. I'd also say that unless we can trap animals like stoats, rats and weasels, your golden plover, your curlew especially, is going to be extinct in 5 years.
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of the extent of usage, Jim, you'll see next week the committee will see when it goes to Buyerclough and Roeburn in the southern uplands, just on a single grouse paw, the extent to which traps are used, which I think hope will be a very useful experience for you all. But in terms of the kind of benefits, I mean, I think Professor Newton actually outlined it beautifully in the previous session. You know, the biodiversity benefits of grouse paw management are in no small part down to effective management of predators, which include, of course, mustelids and corvids, and that's where both trapping infrastructure comes into its own. So I think, the biodiversity benefits are very clear to see. In terms of reporting requirements, I mean, I think, again, Nature Scotland will have the capacity in this legislation to modify a licence for no reason at all. They can just do that instantaneously. Again, that gives the regulator quite a broad degree of discretion. What I would say is that most practitioners already keep very detailed records using apps like EpiCollect, so they're already kind of doing that information collation, so that in itself shouldn't be a problem. But the notion that people could be compelled without good reason, I would say, to provide records, you know, is probably something that we would take a little bit of issue with.
Okay. Can I come back on that? What, you're saying a report without good reason, but the reason would be, and I've had this conversation with various welfare organisations, is the understanding of how many animals are killed on an annual basis for particularly to increase grouse numbers. That would be the challenge that would come back to you. So how do you answer that?
I mean, obviously, that's one of the...
That's not a trick question.
That's one of the motivations, undoubtedly, for it, increasing grouse numbers. But, I mean, we can't also shy away from the other biodiversity benefits. And as I said, keepers are already keeping those detailed records. Mm. I just think if you're handing that sort of information over, you know, I would personally like to know why Nature Scotland would want that information, you know.
Perhaps so that they've got an understanding of what the picture is throughout Scotland.
Yep, so I completely accept that. If they put it a good reason as to why they wanted it, but I don't think it should be applied to everyone unilaterally. I think there should be good reason to actually modify a licence to impose conditions.
So at the moment, on our trap registrations, we only require a return for those folk that are using meat bait. However, you know, we could, if we had good reason, we can... put conditions onto under this legislation, we could put conditions on that registration or licence that required a return. We do that for most of our other licensing types that we issue. Our licences have a condition of at least a final return. Some of our licences have interim returns that people need to submit to us that can include what was taken under that licence. We could put a condition on, you know, where traps were located. You know, there's a variety of things that we could condition if there was a requirement. One of the requirements that we issue conditions on other licence types is purely to find out what's going on, you know, what the impact on populations is, what's being taken through traps, that, you know, so we could do that as a condition on the licence. But we would always have a reason for doing it. Yeah. We don't tend to put unnecessary conditions on any of our licences. The conditions that we put on are always for a reason, and we would articulate that reason to all our licence holders.
Thank you. I'm very aware Rhoda has got to leave the meeting. Would you like to come in with your question, Rhoda?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. We're aware that the Scottish Government might make an announcement about further regulation on snares and that they're gathering evidence on humane cable restraints. And I'm wondering what people's views are on that.
Maybe start with Libby.
Thank you. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission provided a position paper to the Scottish Government which looked at the welfare issues surrounding the use of snares and recommending that they should be banned because of the animal welfare, the animal suffering that they cause. We looked at snares on a generic basis, but we have also looked at humane or modified cabled restraints. The basic operation of the snare is the same, whether it's modified or not, but it has a breakaway mechanism added, it has two swivels, it has a running eye to ensure that the noose relaxes, which it is supposed to do, it has a shorter tail to try and reduce the amount of struggling. So we looked at that and we couldn't really see any fundamental difference between the manner of operating of the conventional type and the new type. The literature that was published by the Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust over 10 years ago identified improved selectivity in the captures. So they were setting out, they caught mainly hares in that trial, but they also caught foxes, but they also caught badgers as well and deer. And the non-target species are supposed to get out of the modified snare more easily. But as far as we are concerned, the animal welfare issues from being captured in a wire noose and restrained for a lengthy period are the same, and they include things like hunger and thirst, fear of predation and actual predation, of course, the struggling which can cause the animal to harm itself. It can suffer from something called capture myopathy, which may not be visible at the time, but is actually a metabolic condition brought on by stress and exertion, usually leads to death. So all of these can still, in our view, be consequences of the use of snares on animals.
Yeah, so I mean, my answer to that, Rhoda, is that we're in a biodiversity emergency. We need to be doing everything we possibly can to reverse biodiversity loss, and snaring is a really important part of the predator management toolkit. You know, we've just seen, severe restrictions placed on the use of using dogs to flush foxes from cover to then be shot. So that's one part of the toolbox pretty much gone, except under licence in very limited circumstances. If this goes as well, then you're left with pretty much one tool in the toolbox, which, of course, is the use of shooting, which is not always possible, nor practicable, nor safe. So our strongest view is that snaring should be retained. And I think I disagree strongly with the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission on this, and it was regrettable that they did not seek to take more evidence. Certainly they didn't come to us to ask for evidence on our thoughts on this, which I think is a bit of a systematic failure, to be honest. But I think it would have been helpful if they did, because I think we've consulted widely with veterinary surgeons on this, and we've got a number of veterinary surgeons now that have endorsed the paper that Libby referred to, that's produced by GWCT, which supports humane cable restraints being retained. And we strongly hope that the Cabinet Secretary, when she does come to make a decision on this, will take that into account, because, you know, there are veterinarians out there who do think that snaring is an integral part of the predator management toolkit, without which we are severely compromising our ability to effectively reverse biodiversity loss. So as a component of the predator management toolkit, absolutely fundamental, and the retention of humane cable restraints, in our view, is fundamental.
Mike.
Just on Ross's point there, I think it'd be a very small minority of vets that actually supported the use of snares. The BVA's kind of position is against them, but that's separate. One, the points that Libby's putting out, they do cause suffering. It's been a bane round our neck that we've opposed snaring for all these years. It's been used against us many times. But in 4 years, complaints that have come to us, and that's how we deal with things. 12 involved in foxes. We had 13 badgers caught. 12 cats, an otter, and 4 deer. They're totally unselective, and the new device will make no difference to that. I've only seen it, to be honest, on the SGA website. To me, it looks like a snare. You can call it what you like, it's still a snare. It's going to cause the same kind of problems, and we will stick by our bit that we totally oppose and would support a full ban on the snares being bought, used, or whatever.
Alec.
Okay. Just saying a wee bit about the snare. I think, first of all, me and Michael agree that often these snaring cases are poachers. They're never gamekeepers. It's nearly every time it'll be set by a poacher and it'll be totally illegal, never check nothing, and the poor animal's choked to death, and it's just horrible to see. But absolutely convinced that this new snare is the unbelievably good. It's got a breakaway on it, which means that when an animal goes in, like a red deer or a roe deer or a badger, it tugs the snare and it just breaks away. It's that wee sort of Kirby grip thing on the snare. It's got 2 swivels. It's got 3 feet only it can move it, like the old snares. The drag across to the pin was maybe 6 feet, but it could get tangled or whatever. So it's very short. Double swivels, like it's almost like a dog collar. And please watch the video if you can, because it's a fox that's been caught in a snare. It was taking my drone, so the thing can't see. You know, the fox can't see what's happening. And without the use of snares, we're going to lose our curlers, and lambing percentages are going to go right down, because sheep farmers are going to go back to the old days where it's just unbelievable amount of foxes. So we need that tool in the box.
Libby wanted to come back in.
Thank you. Very, very quickly, just on Ross's point about our paper, it was a literature review and provided to the Scottish Government, and I think I'm right in saying that the Scottish Government spoke to stakeholders, so I'm pretty sure that was part of the process, so that should have accounted for that. And the other thing is that the modified snares appear to be a recent development in Scotland. As far as I'm aware, there's no official scientific trial. I think they've been used in two locations in Scotland.
We've been using them for 8 years.
Official basis?
No, just official. But I think the other important thing I forgot to say was scientists are using them. They're using them to catch the fox, tag them up with what, you know, their call, radio callers, and then let them go again. So it proves to me that that fox has never been damaged.
I'm just conscious of time again.
A note of clarification there on this evidence, because in the last session, the government official said that the evidence is missing, and they're still gathering it on the new development in snaring techniques such as humane cable restraints.
I'm going to, the final question on snaring, Jim Fairley.
Content.
Are you content? Ariane, you had a supplementary before we moved on.
No, I'm content. I've got that answered. But I've got question 12. Do we have time for me to answer that?
Yep, you've come in with that question. That's fine. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much. So this is on SPCA powers. And Libby, I'd like to direct the question to you. I'd be interested to hear what are the key considerations in coming to a view on whether the Scottish SPCA's powers should be expanded to investigate wildlife crime?
Well, the Commission supported that proposal in the legislation on the basis that wildlife crime causes great harm to animal welfare, and it seemed logical to us that adding a cadre of about 60 trained, experienced inspectors who could gather evidence would promote the cause of animal welfare.
So what would we need to consider in terms of their expanding that power? What would they be getting to do?
Well, they would be allowed to go on to land. This is a little bit beyond my remit, but they'd be allowed to go on to land to gather evidence, which they're not currently able to do. They have powers under the Animal Health and Welfare Act to carry out investigations and gather evidence, but they don't have the equivalent powers under the Wildlife and Countryside Act. And arguably, animal welfare investigations are not able to take place because of the difficulty of responding in a timely manner to these incidents and their remote locations. So there is animal welfare, there is animal suffering out there that's not being investigated because of the resource issue, and it seemed to the Commission that it would be sensible to add all these experienced, trained officers to the body.
Thanks.
Ross.
In response to that question from you, Ariane, I mean, I think I'd refer you to Police Scotland's response to your call for views that you ran, which noted that there may be some confusion as to which agency the public should report incidents to in relation to wildlife crime, which I think is a fair point. They also noted there was a tendency for them to instigate and commence police investigations without police involvement, and that this may ultimately hinder any subsequent police investigation/involvement. They also questioned the ability of the SSPCA to properly look into some aspects of criminal investigations, including financial inquiries, CCTV work, and identifying links to serious and organised crime. The other point that they raise, which we would definitely endorse, is that investigations must remain impartial, and they have basically raised the concern that this could, the SSPCA's views on things like snaring, for example, could create conflicts of interest and call integrity and impartiality into question. And there's also some concerns here over compliance with things like RIPSA, the Scottish crime reporting standards, Lord Advocate's guidance and codes of practice, and they also note that there probably have to be an overhaul of training processes and accountability for the Scottish SPCA. I think we've consulted widely with members on this point, and I think it's fair to say that there's a deficit of trust and confidence in the SSPCA's ability to investigate impartially, and that's supported by things that you see on social media, for example, from kind of official Twitter accounts associated with senior individuals, saying things like disgusting devices in reference to snares, which have no place in modern society. Without doubt, snares should be banned. Disgusting devices that have no place in this day and age. Any claim that snares are selective to only pest species is a total nonsense. Even if they were pest species, can also suffer. And here we've got one that says, but after 30 years, still seeing the dreadful results of snaring, why is this legal? Obviously, this otter was not legally snared, but as long as snares are allowed, such suffering will continue, pest or not. You can see why land managers have concern on seeing evidence like that, that when it comes to legal land management practices, the charity, which is being considered to have statutory powers, is holding partial views. And you can see why people might not feel comfortable or feel that the SSPCA could impartially investigate an incident involving wildlife crime.
Mike.
This is not a new issue. This has been debated since 2010, when it was suggested by an MSP, Peter Peacock, in the Wayne thing. So I think we've been through about five ministers up to date, and it's now hopefully coming to a conclusion. An answer to a concern that Ross and his colleagues have got. No person can be charged or taken to court for something because it doesn't follow our policy. If it's legal, if you phone our helpline at the moment and say there is a snare there, I don't like it, etc., etc., if our inspector goes along and it's a lawfully set snare, it's lawful. Nobody can be prosecuted for that. Santi opposed something that Alex says, but there are gamekeepers. It's not just all poachers that get involved in this kind of thing. And one thing that's always kind of concerned me is the lack of trust that you're talking about seems very, very selective. It's only when it comes to snaring and stuff like that. In the last 4 years, the Scottish SPCA has been solely responsible for reporting 7 offences of badger baiting, 2 of which involve gamekeepers, acting totally against all Alex's rules there. Not one concern from landowners, the police or anybody or the Crown Office has had any concern whatsoever with us investigating badger bears, because they're bad guys. They're definitely wrong. So badgers are wildlife. The offence is a crime. All other crimes are an offence. And wildlife crime does cause suffering. At the moment, my inspectors could go onto land if there is a snared badger and it's alive. If it's dead, it should be the police because of Section 19 powers. One of the things that's caused us problems is we do go, we're dealing with a live animal, because that comes under the 2006 Act, because it's under the control of man, and we look up and we can clearly see stuff. We've then got to go away, report that to the police, and if they've got the manpower to deal with it, they will deal with it. So other offences could be happening. It's only allowing, it would only allow us to do what we're currently doing for all the domestic animals. I've got the figures here that I can give to the panel. Wildlife crime takes up less than 1% of the jobs that come to us. In 2018, 95 reports went to the Procurator Fiscal for animal cruelty. One was for wildlife crime. 2020 was bad because of the badger baiting and stuff. Wildlife crime, it doesn't. We don't class it wildlife crime just because it happens to be a lawful sport that's involved. So anything like that, I'm more than happy to stand by our policy on snaring, because there's plenty of veterinary evidence and evidence that's been in front of court where animals have suffered, mainly probably because of misuse, but there are still people using illegal snares, self-locking snares, which have been banned for a long, long, long time. It's not a new issue. Alec and myself were on a government body 8-9 years ago looking at ways to improve snaring. We still said they should be banned. So it's not something that we're just making up a little policy for. And I've read most of the responses that have come to the panel, and there's two from countryside users. There's two responses. They don't trust us or we're lobbying. Now, the lobbying bit in particular was raised as a form of complaint, took 6 months to investigate, involving between ourselves and the MSPs that were involved, and it was found to be inadmissible. If I was going to try and do backroom lobbying or something like our snaring policy, which is perfectly open and every MSP's probably had it, I'm hardly likely to go on Twitter where anybody can see it and go, by the way, look at me, I'm breaking the law. I'd like to think that we've got a wee bit more sense than that kind of stuff. Not that there's anything wrong going on Twitter that we're not proud to speak about. Lobbying, when it comes to it, practically everything that we ask MSPs for is in writing. So it would be subject to freedom of information and all that kind of stuff. When it comes to the prosecution of crime, we do not prosecute. The police do not prosecute in the big scheme of things. The Crown Office, Procurator, Fiscal Service, which must ensure all the concerns you raised there, whether it's RIPSA compliant, freedom of information, sorry, no freedom of information, Human Rights Act, all these things, disclosure, must be complied with before they would proceed to the case. Any evidence we put forward, the fiscal has got to be satisfied that it's lawfully obtained. You do have an accused, it's in the public interest, there is corroborated evidence. So any thought that we could prosecute somebody for setting a perfectly legal snare or any other trap or any other lawful activity just could not possibly happen. So, as I say, we didn't even make the original request, but we're more than happy to assist the government and the police. It was never intended to replace Police Scotland, who are a fantastic organisation that we work with daily on various things, including organised crime and all these kind of things. So whatever the government decides, and it's not a done deal yet, if they say extra powers and here's the conditions, we'll work with the police, we'll work with government to ensure we can do it, and I can assure you it'll be done to the satisfaction of the Crown Office and the legal requirements.
Can I have the hugest respect, as you know, Mike, for SSPCA, but the government officials have said that SSPCA has some additional resources. But there are concerns, as a charity, it might not be sufficiently neutral. So there is almost an embedded conflict of interest. So if you have donations, which are people donate on the basis of bringing a ban on snares, you could potentially be seen as targeting snaring, whether it's legal or illegal. And it puts the SSPC in a very difficult position. Is that something that you would consider before agreeing to take on additional powers, that it could potentially bring conflicts of interest?
OK, so are you suggesting that us as an organisation or any other organisation should drop a policy or opposing a cruel practice just because it would help us get powers? Because we couldn't do that. The veterinary profession would go nuts.
No, but if you were... Is that something... I'm not suggesting you're doing this for the money or whatever, but if you did, for example, have a campaign to ban snares, but you also then had powers to investigate some of these things or gather evidence, there could be a suggestion that because you're getting the bulk of your income from the anti-snaring body, that you are disproportionately targeting that to provide evidence that... I'm not suggesting that you're doing something for the wrong reason, but there could be the implication of that.
That's an inference that people can make. It could, as I've explained, it couldn't happen. If it's just because something we don't like, we have to get past the Procurator Fiscal. They have got to be satisfied that there is sufficient evidence. If they thought we were doing anything on the back of a campaign, we ourselves would be in trouble. When it comes to misappropriation, if somebody complains about an inspector's conduct, we didn't try and make excuses, tell the police. If we've acted unlawfully, go to the police. If we'll, anybody that kind of falsified evidence should be subject to the court, contempt of court, perjury, attempting to defraud the public and all that kind of stuff. So we're entirely open. I'm not going to break my heart if we're not given these extra powers.
Yeah, but
we've
I suppose
plenty to keep us going. And it's the same token, you're saying that we could be seen to be campaigning for that. All the kind of same allegations could be made about our domestic animal work. Nobody ever complains about that when we find the skinny dogs, the stab dogs, all this kind of stuff. And as I say, when it comes to wildlife crime, it seems to be, if it's a Ned, for want of a better word, doing it, everybody supports us. But if it's somebody that could be perceived to be part of the countryside legal set, there's opposition. I don't know where this mistrust comes from. I've had great relationships with Alec for, 25 plus years. Then you always agree, but I can easily talk to him. Yeah. When it comes to visiting people and stuff, Ross, yourself, Alec, any member of this committee is welcome to visit any of your centres, spend a day with an inspector, as the ones that have taken up that offer. We've got our wildlife centre, which deals with between 8,000 and 10,000 wild animals a year. You're all welcome to come and see it. We're open, we've got nothing to hide.
Yeah, so that certainly wasn't implying that you had anything to hide, but I suppose it was a difficult position that you could be put in. So you may have additional resources, but we all know that resources are absolutely limited. And given some of your other roles, the cost of living crisis, whatever, you're facing challenges. But you may be asked to make priorities or prioritise your work, and that could in some way potentially be down to your income. And the availability of resources. Would it be right would you need to be directed on what your priorities were within dealing with wildlife, or it would be something that SSPCA would look to prioritise?
We would take cognizance of what the government suggests and what any protocol with the police happens. We can only investigate something and take it forward, obviously, if it's a crime. If it's not a crime, we're not going to investigate it. We will take cognizance of whatever the officials say, whatever this committee and the parliament decides we are allowed to do, we'll comply with it. But everybody's resources are finite, but what, as I explained at the very beginning, I'm talking about, in the majority of cases, it's members of the public have called us. We're already there dealing with a live animal, So it is a duplication of resource. We're there, and then we've got to phone the police to come to do the same bit. And don't get me wrong, we've got the powers under the 2006 Act. There is absolutely nothing to stop us investigating wildlife crime under the 1981 Act, with all the loopholes it's got, not the loopholes, all the barriers we've got to go through, because we've not got Section 19 powers, because we're also recognised as a specialist reporting agency. So we have had wildlife and countryside cases, but we've got to get warrants and all that stuff, which is quite right. No problem with all that. So it's there in the round. But to answer your question, if the government says this is that, but nobody could turn around and say, you can investigate crime, but you can't investigate that bit of crime, because the law says it's there. Ultimately, it's up to the fiscal if a case goes forward, and then ultimately it's the decision of the court.
Thank you. I've got Alex, and then I think yes, also wanted to come back.
Yeah, Mike and me have got utmost respect for each other, especially when Mike finds a starving pony in a field or something. Just admiration. But when it comes to the investigative powers, I only think the people that should be doing this is the police, Police Scotland, because they're the only fair organisation to look at things. And they've also got far more powers now. Yeah. Wildlife crime has become really serious. So I believe it should be down to police.
Can I just make a point, Convener, just for the committee's awareness? So we obviously raised a lot of concerns about the notion that an official investigation could be grounds for suspension, even if the regulator isn't satisfied a relevant offence has been committed. If, say for sake of argument, the SSPCA are given powers to investigate wildlife crime, then their initiation of an official investigation would then be cause for a licence to then potentially become suspended. And given our concerns over partiality, and given that Mike, you know, great respect for Mike, but, you know, did not address a lot of the kind of key points that I think the Police Scotland have rightly put on the record on this point, you know, it's not something I think we can support. So, I've got, you know, just personally some big questions over, you know, the extent to which I suppose the SSPCA inspectors are vetted and trained compared to what police officers go through, because obviously there's rigorous vetting process and stuff, you know, that are right and proper, you know, and I don't feel perhaps that those processes are in place. But I'll pick up with Mike offline, I'll take up his offer on that, which is very helpful. But I think as an organisation, and, you know, just having spoken to numerous people on this topic now, literally gone round the country helping people with their consultations and hearing what they have to say, this is an issue that goes across the countryside, and it's not through us, our influence or anything like that. People have got misgivings for whatever reason about the Scottish SPCA being afforded enhanced powers to investigate wildlife crime because of things like what I just set out with respect to the licence suspension.
That's perfectly fine. You criticised earlier on that the Scottish Welfare Commission didn't examine fully. You never spoke to us about your concerns. My phone's always on. If you've got a concern, please phone me. Alex's point about the pony in the field, the evidential burden's the same. It doesn't matter if it's an animal in a cage, in an illegal cage, and it's suffered, or a pony that's starving in a field. The evidential burden's the same. Whatever decided, if powers have decided, and if it comes to the fact that in certain bits we are not recognised as carrying out an investigation because of no police that have done it, that's something that will be worked out in a protocol. As opposed to us phoning in Nature Scotland and saying that may have to come through the police, whatever. All that's open.
You know, and they wouldn't have protection, because what it says is the initiation of an official investigation. That's you responding to a phone call. That is what constitutes an official investigation. We've spoken to, you know, retired police officers about this who confirmed as such. You know, if you get a phone call alleging criminality and you go and investigate that, then technically, in law, Nature Scot would have the power to suspend someone's licence, to shoot grouse, to trap, to make me urban whatever.
Yeah,
you know?
I cannot see even the police, and I can't speak for the police, getting a phone call, phoning up licence, saying cancel their thing.
That's not
they're
what we're saying.
Go, and before they could say it's an official investigation, they're going to have to see some form of criminality.
That's not what
I mean,
we're
that's
saying.
That's common sense.
That's not what we're saying. It doesn't provide protection in law. We're talking about safeguards, legal protections for our members, and, you know, frameworks, standing operating procedures. They don't provide that legal protection. You know, that's all we're asking for here is to get that protection recognised. But as it stands, Liz could, I'm not saying she would, but she could, on the basis of you establishing an investigation, revoke someone's licence. Now, I've got every confidence in Liz, but, you know, that's the worry that we've got. If someone came in that maybe had a different agenda and it just got changed their operation, that could happen. You know, in law, it would be conceivable.
Certainly more than happy to discuss this offline meeting.
Great, yeah. I'd appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, well, no. This is certainly something we'll pick up when we have the police and Procreate, I think we have in front of us, and the police in future sessions. That brings us to the close of this session. Thank you very much for your contribution. That's been hugely helpful. I'm now going to suspend this meeting and ask that the public remove, so we'll move into private session.